Hey, wait a minute, fellas. Here you are. En route to...
How are you?
I'm fine, thanks. How are you?
Wait a minute. You want to...
You like my smile, you like my style, well, why don't you make me know it? You like my walk, you like my talk, well, there's only one way to show it. If you want to shake my hand, like they do it in Harlem, stick your hand right out and shout, give me some skin, my friend. Step right up and take your stand, you don't have to be timid. Stick your hand right out and shout, give me some skin, my friend. Smack it, whack it, let your hand rotate. Show it, blow it, put it in your pocket till a future date. If you want to shake my hand, like they do it in Harlem, stick your hand right out and shout, give me some skin, my friend. If you like my style, we'll show it. If you like my smile, let me know it. If you like my walk, please tell me. My talk will skin me, papa, skin me. If you want to shake my hand like they do it in Harlem, baby, stick your hand right out and shout, give me some skin, my friend. Step right up and take your stand. You don't have to be timid, baby. Stick your hand right out and shout, give me some skin, my friend. Smack it, whack it, my friend. Let your hand rotate. Show it, blow it, put it in your pocket till a future date. Step right up and shake my hand like they do it in Harlem today.
How do they do it?
Just stick your hand out and tip out with a shout, give me some skin, my friend.
Shake my hand like they do it in Harlem. Stick your hand right out and shout, give me some skin. Give me some skin. Give me some skin, my
cause the words I manifest, they will take you, sedate you, and I will stress upon you the need for you all to feed your minds and souls, so you can lead yourself to peace. I got a real objective here, I am effective here, cause I select a clear method for all. Suckers I maul, they fall and crawl into the pit of purgatory. I go for glory, I'm taking inventory, counting all the tough luck ducks while I marry, relate and equate, dictate and debate, cause my fate is to be co-making history. I use sincerity, but I still bury the doubts and questions of all the skeptics. I'm kicking clout and I'll even bet this is true. There's nothing so-so, cause I know right about this minute, I'm in it, admit it, I did it for you, cause this is what I'm into. So chill while I instill that we almost fulfilled the proper mission for us. And yo, this is a must. To these lines of my rhymes, I attest. I attest. Huh. These are the words that I manifest. I manifest. I manifest. Take a
rest. For the words I manifest, they will scold you and mold you. While I impress upon you the fact that I use much tact that rhyme and co-climate. And chill while I attract that girl you're with. I got a sense of quality. I'll give her all of me, cause you're too small to be trying to rip. So let me uplift and shift my gift. Let's go to the fullest capacity. I got tenacity, because I have to be the brother who must live and give with much insight and foresight to ignite, excite, and delight. And you might gain from it, or feel pain from it, because I'm ultimate, and I'm about to let off. Knowledge, wisdom, understanding, truth with coup. So won't you throw a hand in the air, put up a peace sign, and please find that though we're feeling good, we should, we could, we would. Stop. Think for a moment, okay, and then sway while I convey that we must do away with all the stress and the strife. God bless your life and use kindness, and never blindness. And you will find that this perspective is best. Check it out. These are the words that I manifest. I manifest.
By which she attained freedom, reached freedom, got her freedom. What method did she...
This man preaches in terms of race and against integration. The white man is the enemy. This is Malcolm X, leader in Harlem of a cult that calls themselves Muslims or Muslims. They are a leading force behind the campaigns to buy black, part of the doctrine of their national leader, a man called Elijah Muhammad. Outsiders call it black supremacy. Malcolm X calls it black heritage or Negro nationalism. It appeals for Negro unity, and it looks to Africa for inspiration.
He says Africa. The Egyptians are African. The honorable, my brother who stood here from Egypt is an African. Two Africans are back there in the corner. You've got all kinds of shades of Africans, just like you have all shades of us here. Everywhere this white man has gone, he has left his mom. So we're gonna... President Nasser in Egypt, or of the United Arab Republic, is just as much an African as an African in the Belgian Congo. And if you don't think so, one of the men in the East that the white imperialists, as you call, or the white European, as you call, or the white American, as you call, the devil, who we call. The greatest, one of his worst enemies and most feared opponents in the East today is President Jamal Nasir. The man in America whom the slave master fears but respects more so than any black man in the West is the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Elijah Muhammad, born Elijah Poole in Alabama, calls himself the Messenger. His Harlem branch, or temple, is in this unimposing building. In other cities, the cult has its own stores and schools. For the latest rally, at least 5,000 turned up. The Messenger, who works out of Chicago, failed to show up. But the hardcore of his disciples, the trained bodyguard, stood on duty for hours. Neat, orderly. Courtesy, they say, is part of their creed. Just how many converts they've made in Harlem, this is hard to say. Perhaps 1,000, possibly 5 or 10,000. By many people in Harlem, their influence is discounted. By others, it is deplored. But the message is being circulated. A strong tonic being offered as a cure for Harlem's troubles. The troubles we've already examined, and some others which we'll look into in just a moment, when we resume with part two of Harlem, a Self-Portrait.
My father's mother, she told me her father was a white slave master.
Right.
And she looked it.
Yes.
Today, my women here today, daughters, girls, all subject to your own biddings. You take their sons today, bash the brains in with nightclubs, blow the brains out with your gun throughout the country without any due process of law that you have already put here before them. Law of justice, you have it, but we don't enjoy it. Just for yourself. You have, in words, trodden us under feet in the mire of civilization.
That's right. That's what it is.
And now today, you stand as our chief adversary to prevent us from escaping your own evil and unjust doings to our people. Whose sweat and blood has helped you to build the greatest country and government on the earth. You are so rich today that you are able to feed almost every mouth in Europe and to clothe them. You are so rich that you can throw away billions of dollars to nation to get their friendship. You are so rich and so powerful that you command the high seas.
Right.
the air,
right.
The land,
right.
Even to the ice caps,
right.
Of the poles of the earth.
Right.
All this we help you to do.
Right.
We are still standing.
It's the condition that black men and women suffer for 400 years causing us to live like this. Let me clear up something here. You know, I'm not a Negro. You who are, I'm not poking fun at you, but I'm not a Negro. I'm not colored. I am a black nationalist, and it's heavy on black. I'm a black nationalist of African descent. I see we have some members here from the European stock. And I'm very glad to see you. I want you to know that we don't hate you. We feel sorry for you. The whole white world is a victim of a lie. And this lie is about to destroy them. What was an empire yesterday become poverty stricken today. All you got to do is to look at your map and remember how the world was 10 years ago and look at it now. And in the last 10 years, there has been a constant transition period where black men and yellow men have awakened, and in their awakening, they have told the European, you've got to leave here now, and you can't take no more what you've been taking that belongs to me. The day of white supremacy is over. It never was in the beginning. But we've been asleep for a little while. And the only reason why the white man has been on top is because we held him up there. But now we're about ready to release him. We done put fuck in all his wars, been lynched, been discriminated, been Jim Crow. Now it's almost over. I'm not so concerned about the White House no more. I don't particularly care whether I go to Albany anymore. It don't make no difference whether I become mayor of New York City anymore. Anything that I think is doomed, I don't want no parts of it. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you know, talking is cheap. But we can't all condemn the white man. There's something we got to do. The white man is doomed, but we got to help him on his way. I don't mean in the jest of hate. I mean according to the plan of divine providence. He that has been up a long time must come down. He that's been down a long time must rise. I'm almost off the subject that I plan to speak on. I hope the chairman will give me just a few minutes. In my conclusion, they don't want you to develop no economic progress in this country. That's why they keep selling you this bill of goods on integration. And if you'll notice that the people who advocate integration is trying to advocate you broke. Because these Negroes that come and tell you about we want integration, you'll notice he always wants you to integrate to spend, never to make no money, always wind up spending the money. Now, if he was talking about integrating in Wall Street, General Motors, A&T, and all these big industries, I'd say I'm for it. But just to go in the man's hotel and sleep in his bed, I said later for you.
Your dope peddler right now, he's a Christian. If you catch a whiskey peddler right now, he's a Christian. Now, I'm not attacking Christianity, but let's face the facts. This is the thing that is primarily responsible for the condition that our people are in. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad has stopped us from stealing, and we did steal. He stopped us from gambling. He stopped us from cheating, and he stopped us from lying. Stealing runs rampant in Harlem. Gambling runs rampant in Harlem. All types of evils and vices that tear apart our community run rampant in Harlem. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad doesn't condemn the victim. He goes to work on the victim. He doesn't say that all of you should go to jail because you have fallen victim to the evils that white man has brought into the community. He teaches you and me the religion that God has given to him as the only cure for the evil habits the white man has brought here among us. Profanity, you don't find it among Muslims. He stopped us from using profanity, from being boisterous, from being rude and loud, and encourages us to be courteous, mannerly, and to exercise discipline and respect for authority at all times. He teaches us to obey the law, to respect law enforcement officers, as long as these law enforcement officers respect themselves and respect the law that they represent. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad has eliminated laziness from among his followers. He teaches us to be thrifty, channel our money that we earn in an intelligent direction. He has taken us out of the tavern. We don't throw our money away there. He has taken us out of the bars and the nightclubs. We don't throw our money away there. We don't stand on the corner now without a job. When you become a Muslim, he makes us get a job. He makes us go to work. He makes us exercise or exert energy in our own behalf. And all of this type of teaching that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is doing among the black people in this country has been instrumental in producing a new type of people, a new thinking people, people with a new action, a new attitude, and a new behavior. And even the worst critics of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, though it hurts their heart to do so, have to admit that he has made better people out of those of us who follow him better than we were before we became his followers. Don't let the white man speak for you, and don't let the white man fight for you. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us that it is time for you and me to stand up for ourselves. It is time for you and me to see for ourselves. It is time for you and me to hear for ourselves. And it is time for you and me to fight for ourselves. We don't need anybody today speaking for us, seeing for us, or fighting for us. We'll fight our own battles with the help of our God. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad says, seek good, don't seek evil. try to please God. Forget trying to please the devil. Make yourself acceptable to God instead of being so worried about being acceptable to the devil. Try and integrate with God instead of trying to integrate with the devil. Devil means an adversary. Adversary is that which is against you. Anybody that opposes your freedom is a devil. Anybody that opposes justice for you is a devil. The devil is the one who brings the alcohol. The devil is the one who brings the dope. The devil is the one who brings the reefer. Away from you, you get the shakes. You can't do without it. That cigarette that you smoke is as much dope or narcotic. A white gorilla named Uncle Sam. Because Uncle Sam gets his cut. One of his largest sources of revenue is the cigarette tax. One of his largest sources of revenue is the whiskey tax. Let the devil go by. As long as you are addicted to the vices of the white man, when you call on God, God doesn't hear your prayer. And the white man knows it. But the white man also knows that when you clean yourself up, straighten yourself up, and get on God's side and call on God, God has got to answer your call. God today is going to destroy the devil. God's purpose is to destroy the devil. God's plan is to destroy the author of sin and evil and indecency and immorality. The killing of our beloved brother Ronald T. Stokes. Ronald Stokes was not the least among the followers of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. He was one of the highest. He was the secretary of our Los Angeles mosque. And as we explained in that rally on May, many of you thought that we should go right on out then and make war on the white man. You wanted to do it yourself, didn't you? Didn't you? You wanted some action then, didn't you? Because you don't like the idea of white people shooting black people down, do you? And you're ready to do something about it, aren't you? We know you are. And the white man should be thankful that God has given the Honorable Elijah Muhammad the control over his followers that he has, so that they can play it cool, calm, and collected, and leave it in the hands of God. This was explained at the last rally. That nine of our brothers were indicted in Los Angeles for crimes that they weren't guilty of. 45, the same headline that said nine Muslims indicted, the same paper, I should say, that headlined the fact that nine Muslims were indicted, also headlined the fact that a jet had crashed on the way to Los Angeles with 45 of those people on it. Also, on May the 20th, month and one day after Brother Ronald was shot in cold blood by the Los Angeles police, the white man suffered the worst economic crisis he has had since back in 1929. He called it Black Monday. The stock market went down. And when you hit the... So, again, since there has been so much trouble here in Brooklyn recently, especially at the Downstate Medical Center, isn't that what they call that place? The only why they call it Downstate. there has been a great deal of hope that the Muslims would condemn the so-called Negro preachers and their efforts to make the government and the city and the country give them equal job opportunities. The white man knows that this demand for equality of opportunity is just. He knows he has no defense against what he has done to black people in this country. He has no explanation, no justification. There's nothing he can say actually but keep his mouth shut.
We will participate with all other organizations in a voter registration drive to get as many of our people in this country as listed as registered voters. But we will also have a voter education drive that will be designed to give them an understanding of what the politician is supposed to produce for the people in the community, so that they will then know whether or not these politicians are keeping their promise, or what the politician could do that he's not doing.
Although there was a march and nearly 200 arrests in nearby Marion, Negroes in Selma did not march today, and there was an uneasy quiet as they hung around their church rallying point, listening to their leaders and even to an uninvited guest. He was Malcolm X, the former black Muslim leader, now head of the black nationalists. King's staff was wary of his presence with Dr. King.
We're nonviolent. But when you're dealing with an enemy who doesn't know what nonviolence is, as far as I'm concerned, you're wasting your time.
One guest who was definitely invited was Mrs. Coretta King, wife of Dr. Martin Luther King. She arrived today from Atlanta to visit her husband in jail and to spur on the civil rights effort.
I came down also to say to you that you have my support. I want to commend you for the courageous job that you are doing. As a native of this part of the country, and having been born and reared in Perry County, Alabama, I'm very proud of what's happening there and in Selma.
Mrs. King, along with Mrs. Ralph Abernathy, went to Selma's jail to see their husbands, who have chosen to remain behind bars rather than post a $200 bond and go free. But the women were told that only lawyers could see their clients at any time. Relatives had to wait until visiting day, which is Sunday.
Well, we are trying to catch up with some of the people that had been present in the Audubon Ballroom, and we want to question these people who we know had seen the act committed. And up until the present date, we have been unsuccessful in catching up with some of these people who have, whom we know the names of, but who have been given fictitious addresses throughout the city of New York.
Do you think they are deliberately avoiding the police?
I think they are.
Why?
Well, it's a matter of conjecture. I think that some may be in a state of shock yet over the assassination. But on the other hand, it's amazing to me that, and to the police department, that in view of the fact that these people and followers had been dedicated and believed in his philosophy, that at this time, after the leader was brutally slain, that they remain incognito and will not come forth and give us some information which they have knowledge of.
Do you know now the identity of the two men who were said to have also shot Malcolm X?
I cannot make a comment on that question at this time.
What step is your investigation now?
Well, there's been talk of that, but I strongly advocate at this time that that's a matter for us to take action and not them.
James Farmer, the director of CORE, an international political conspiracy, Has your investigation found anything that would...
Up until and including the present time, that hasn't appeared in the investigation.
Do you think a federal investigation is warranted then?
Well, Ms. Fantales, that would be primarily up to the federal authorities themselves if they saw fit. But at the present time, I am firmly convinced that this is a matter of the police of the city of New York.
It's just been disclosed that there's a group called the Revolutionary Action Movement that is present and highly militant. Do you think this group might be connected with the killing?
As I said before, I have no evidence, or we have no evidence, to associate this group with the death of Malcolm X.
Could you associate them with the bombing?
Not at the present time.
How close are you to solving the bombing?
Well, I hope we are close, but I cannot give you any details relative to the investigation at this time.
Do you think that when you find out who killed Malcolm X, you'll also know who bombed the mosque?
That's problematical.
Cut, please.
At the Coliseum, the security... An unknown number of them inside, posing as even tighter, if that's possible. About 50 officers were assigned to cover the meeting hall. Started the Coliseum was searched for bombs. The Muslims added their own protective measures. These disciplined men are known as the fruit of Islam, karate experts who serve as Elijah Muhammad's tough bodyguard. They gave an intensive shakedown to each person entering the hall, detailed and carefully carried out. But the start of the meeting was delayed almost an hour, and the long line formed outside and the 22 had criticized and got what he preached. When
it is not that white people cannot believe. It is true. We have lots of white people in this country that is Muslim. And the belief.
Right, your father.
We have people in Europe that believe. We have our country over there to call Turkey. Muslim country. Now, here is what I am teaching. Allah says to me, by nature they are not Muslim.
In view of his reservations, is this still Meredith's march?
The march is taken in his name, as I understand. I mean, their basic premise is to help black people get rid of the fear, and that's what we're working with. We're working to understand that the only people who can deal with those problems are black people. They have to start dealing with them themselves. They can't depend on anybody. They can't depend on the federal government because it's jive. It's not going to do anything.
You may think this is the James Meredith Mississippi March Against Fear. That is over. This is a line of emotional momentum which changes with its rotating leadership. When Dr. King is up front for a couple of hours, it becomes a liberation walk. When Floyd McKissick of CORE is there, it is a registration drive. And when Stokely Carmichael of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee leads, it is a Black Power March. Carmichael was one of those arrested for pitching tents in a Negro schoolyard without permission. On release last night, he preached his favorite sermon to a crowd of 1,000.
They've kept us out by force and by guns. Now that's what's wrong with that. The fact is they kept us out with their guns in the South and in the North with their laws. Now we're going to get something and we're going to get it to represent it. And we ain't worried about whether or not it's all black. Don't be afraid. Don't be ashamed. We want black power. 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 That's right, that's what we want, black power. And we don't have to be ashamed of it. We have stayed here and we begged the president. We begged the federal government. That's all we've been doing, begging, begging. It's time we stand up and take over. Every courthouse in Mississippi ought to be burned down tomorrow to get rid of the dirt and hair. Now from now on, when they ask you what you want, you know what to tell them. What do you want? What do you want? What do you want? Everybody, what do you want?
There was vengeful power in a speech by Charles Evers of the Mississippi NAACP. a threat to Byron DeLay Beckwith, who was tried and never convicted for the killing of Medgar Evers.
We're in a town tonight where when Beckwith came back home, the city and many of its good white citizens met him down the road and hollered, "Welcome home, Delilah, welcome home." We're tired of it. I understand he still runs around here now and harass Negroes. Well, you know he's nothing but a coward because I got Newz for him. If I ever lay my eyes on him, if I ever get in hand reach of him, he'll be through harassing Negroes.
This march has become all things to all men. To redneck hecklers at the crossroads, it is a joke without mirth. To the state of Mississippi, it is a parade that no longer needs 20 protecting patrolmen, only 4 for traffic. To Negro marchers, it is defiant release. To white marchers, something to do with their compassion. To the revolving leadership, it is a prize of emotion and attention, a club over Congress, a wedge into black fear. To James Meredith, who walked without organizers, or tents, or portable restrooms, it is a 4th of July picnic. To more than 100 newsmen who ignored Meredith, it is a chance to polish our competitive image by being on hand for the next shotgun blast. Burning a courthouse may destroy a symbol of white power, but will it humanize the real power that remains? And in its wake, for the field hands who remain behind, chopping cotton, $3 a day, lights, and Social Security deducted, is it a march against fear as advertised? John Hart, CBS News, near Greenwood, Mississippi.
Commended for your discipline, your dignity, and your adherence to nonviolence in the midst of provocative. Today we have faced men with hatred written on their faces. Today we have faced men who would like to carry America backwards instead of forward. And yet we have stood up with determination, with zeal, and with courage. Now we know this county. In this county, Andrew Goodman, James Cheney, and Michael Swerner were brutally murdered. And I believe in my heart that the murderers are somewhere around me at this moment. And I think today they ought to search their hearts. I think today they ought to stand before their God. Yes. And we want them to know that we are standing here not afraid.
Yes. Yes. Amen.
If they kill 3 of us, they're going to have to learn that they'll have to kill all of us.
Amen. Amen.
Watch it!
Come on, build a line!
Move it up!
I think this is an indictment on the intelligent citizens of Neshoba County, if there are any left. I think the enforcement officers, the law enforcement officers, are really making it hard on the intelligent citizens of Neshoba County that would like to see peace and order and justice. I live in Mississippi. I'm a citizen anywhere in this state and in this country. Well,
I'm disturbed about a strange theory that is circulating, saying to me that I ought to imitate the worst in the white man and the worst in our oppressors. Who has a victory of killing and lynching people and throwing them in rivers? It's our oppressors, and now people are telling me to stoop down to that level. Oh, no!
Oh, no!
Low as to use the very method that has perpetuated evil throughout our civilization. I'm sick and tired about it. I'm tired of the war in Vietnam. I'm tired of war and conflict in the world. I'm tired of shooting. I'm tired of hate. I'm tired of selfishness. I'm tired of evil. I'm not going to use violence, no matter who says it.
This is the street where it was worth your life last night to be a white man, where a white man had no business in this Philadelphia Negro enclave. It is worthy of that military term with its night armed guards, its rooftop sentries, its wireless communications, its passwords. Honk twice if you're a friend. This is where retaliation was written into the nonviolent creed, where today in storefront conversations, nonviolence is being redefined, if not discarded.
See, I'm tired of getting down there saying I'm non-violent on my knees and that man whipping the hell out of me and don't nobody care. See, I'm tired of that.
I'm not talking about self-defense. I believe in defending yourself.
But I'm saying I don't know. If a bunch of nuts come through here and want to throw a cocktail, I just might do it. Because I'm right there now. See, non-violent hadn't paid off.
It's just a response to direct attack. You know, the community, the people have never said they were so much nonviolence, and the leaders have been saying that they were nonviolent.
Does that mean that that nonviolent leadership has lost its leading power?
Oh, I would suspect that that's close to the truth, yes.
Is it safe to say a white man is not safe in this neighborhood at night?
Well, I think that if a white man comes over here and takes provocative action, that it's safe to say that he's not safe. Yet.
I haven't had any contact with the president or the governor. I understand that contact has been made with the governor by the Justice Department and also from Washington, local Justice Department officials who are here and Washington, and that Governor Johnson plans to have the state patrol there in large numbers tomorrow, and we are going anyway. Nothing will deter us from going back to Philadelphia.
Are you satisfied that you can prevent Negro retaliation in this case?
I'll do everything I can. I can't guarantee anybody that I can control every Negro in this county or in the United States, but I will be doing everything I can. I think most of the people are committed to tactical nonviolence, and I think that we will be able, by and large, to control any outbreaks of violence from our side.
A small but bloody action that's typical of this kind of war. Two companies of Americans, one of the 101st Airborne and one of the 1st Air Cavalry, chasing a communist force through the hills between the coastline of the South China Sea to the east and a special forces camp in the highlands a few miles to the west. All this is communist country and has been since the days the Viet Minh were fighting the French. Government forces have rarely penetrated these hills and never have controlled them. This latest fighting began last weekend when three outposts of the special forces camp were overrun by the enemy. Local Vietnamese defenders suffered heavy losses. Now the communists are taking losses as we pursue them village by village, a hedgerow at a time. The weapons and the prisoners that have been taken so far look like the North Vietnamese regular army. On our side, we've taken some losses, too. Lieutenant Alan Christensen of Severna Park, Maryland, has been a platoon leader through all of this latest fighting.
We've been hit. We've been here three nights now. They've hit us every night. Last night, they got us with 81 mortars and rocket launchers, automatic weapons fire from all the hills around. But we're in pretty good shape right now. They hadn't got into our positions yet. We got quite a few. We counted 30 bodies yesterday that we got, and we still haven't finished counting today.
How about your losses?
I don't know. When we find all the VC, I think we'll come out pretty good. We've lost a lot of people, but we're in pretty good shape.
Yeah, we're getting in fast enough, over.
The operation is under the command of one of the most celebrated soldiers of the Vietnam War, Colonel Hal Moore of the 1st Air Cavalry Division. He's due to go back to the States next Monday.
So far, we've captured either two or three officers with pistols, and they voluntarily surrendered, and we've captured three or four more. Some are wounded, and we're interrogating them now.
How does it feel to be involved in something of this sort, Colonel, just a few days before you're due to leave for home?
Well, I'm here until I go back to the States, and while I'm here, I'm here to command this brigade, and I'm not looking forward 3 or 4 days hence, or however long it is. We're here to kill the enemy.
It's a bitter and bloody process, driving the enemy from ridge to ridge, from hole to hole, but that's the kind of war it is. And with all our air power, artillery, and air mobility, it's still the ground troops who have to go in and get them one at a time. Bill Stout, CBS News, Trung Phan Province.
Well, I made the challenge to Cassius Clay because I feel that the heavyweight championship belongs to all Americans, and it's something that we should be proud of. All Americans should be proud of. I also feel that it should not be in the hands of one group of people, and that's the Muslims. It gives a very bad example as far as the foreign countries are concerned, and even our country. Now, many of the people may think that this is merely a publicity thing, and it's a move to get the championship, to get a chance, to get the chance to win the championship back, but they're wrong, because I am not taking any money for the fight, and whenever I do get the championship, I would be willing to sign papers to give the championship back to one of the other logical contenders, but I just don't like to see it in the hands of one group of people, and that's what Malcolm X stands for.
And you think naturally that you could take Clay?
Well, if I didn't feel that I could, I wouldn't fight him. I have a lot of respect for him, but I still think that I can beat him.
Cassius Clay stated, you can't stop me. I'm the world's greatest. I'm the world champ. You don't bother me.
Knew who I was. The driver told him who I was. He said, I don't care who he is. He's nothing to me. I'm so-and-so. I'm a policeman. He's not on television now with his big talk. I'm just going into this stuff. Then he grabs me with one arm and he turns me around. He starts to search me all over and patting around me like I might have dope or whiskey.
We asked him if he had any weapons upon him. He said, no, only Sonny Liston carries weapons. He said, I'm a black Muslim. I'm a peace-loving man. So we don't carry weapons.
What was his attitude after that?
He was very arrogant and became very loud and boisterous and created a scene upon the street, causing many people in the area to gather.
Then he wants to throw me in the wagon. I says, now there's no reason to throw me in the wagon. Why do you want to throw me in the wagon? I said, I'll get in the car. If you're going to take me down, you have a right. Put me in the car. Don't just push me in no wagon. If I was Ingemar Johansson or Rocky Marciano or some top-notch white movie star athlete, I don't think you would just pat him down and have no respect for his position, authority, and just throw him in a wagon like that.
We stated to get into the squad role. He refused. He kept saying to me, go ahead, hit me with your club, hit me with a club. I said, no, there's no need for that. You go peacefully into the wagon. He refused. Finally, he agreed to go into the squad car.
I've never been in a courthouse, never been in no type of women's scandals, never been in a jail, don't drink, don't smoke. I'm even forbidden to go inside bars and serve alcohol. Certain TV shows I can't take because I'm a clean, righteous liver. And I don't want to, this is embarrassing to me. Just a way for the policeman to get a name. His name got in the news. He's world famous now.
Have you come here to walk also?
walk? No, sir. By me being a follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, we do not believe in forced integration. We will go where we are welcome, but as our leader Elijah Muhammad teaches us, there will always be bloodshed in America as long as our people are trying force integration, because the nature of the black and the white will never mix. And the only solution that we preach and believe is total separation of the races. So by me representing total separation of the races, it wouldn't be proper for me to march to live with somebody who don't want me and possibly get killed just to, you know, live in a white neighborhood.
Well, champ, on your induction or the possibility of it into the Army, you have now appealed to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court, in effect, said that you must go into the Army. If you lose that appeal to the Supreme Court, what do you do?
Well, the Supreme Court, the American government has its laws, and Almighty God and the religion of Islam has its laws. And I have made it plain that I will face machine gun fire before I break the laws of Allah and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. So I imagine we have many more hot days ahead of us.
Well, there is a report that you're considering now going into the Army, or that you are considering other moves
falsehood. I haven't yet made no statement of considering going into Army. I even act like I wanted to.
Well, what other moves are you planning other than the appeal to stay out?
Well, I'm not really just planning to stay out, just to stay out. I'm just following my religious beliefs. And the only thing that I'm doing now is meditating and praying praying to Allah, and just to make me strong to withstand any pressures or suffering that will be put on me.
Slating the interview with Muhammad Ali. Is there no way that you will go into the Army?
No way possible.
In other words, you expect to be jailed.
Well, if I don't expect to be jailed, and I don't want to be jailed. But if it means being persecuted here in America for my religious beliefs, then I'm ready to face machine gun fire. Whatever it is, I don't want to go nowhere. But if it means being persecuted to jail because of the religion of Islam and its teachings, then I'm ready to die. My people. Well, in other words, what's happening here in Louisville, Kentucky, my own hometown, has shocked me and upset me, and my concern is greater for this and my people's freedom here more so than what's happening in the Vietnam with the South.
Well, you say when you're expected to go into the Army and maybe die in Vietnam, does that mean that you've reconsidered the possibility of going into the Army to serve? Or
no, sir.
Are you still...
No, sir. Yeah, I'm still a Muslim, and I'm still a follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad to the death, and whatever suffering that I will receive for standing up for my religious beliefs, which is the same of 600 more million Muslims on earth, whatever suffering that I may, persecution that I may receive from my religion, even if it means death, I'm willing to face it head on. But this has really disturbed me and shook me to see what's going on here in Louisville, Kentucky. And this has upset me more than the people's freedom in South Vietnam.
Well, what are you going to do? What are you going to do tonight? Are you going to do anything to try to help the situation here?
No, I may be invited to say a few words, but I'm just here to let the people know that I am with them in their struggle. But what I really hate to see is the women and the pregnant girls and the little children meeting vicious, wild people, well-armed, and they have nothing, like little humble sheep. I think that the men, if they're going to go to war, if they're going to demonstrate for freedom, all wise leaders and all people, when they want freedom, they leave the woman at home. Her job is raising children, cooking food, sending the man off to war, and comforting him. It's intelligent and an embarrassment in the eyes of the world to see these beautiful women and humble children being brutalized and kicked up. And this really makes the men nothing but boys to allow women to be... I would like to express that to them, if it would help. Just keep the women at home if they're going to go forcing themselves on other people. Keep the women at
walk
home.
Also.
Saturday, the convention moved into an Oakland high school for workshop sessions on building black economic and political power and building Negro self-image. From the viewpoint of the core leadership, these workshops are the most important part of the convention. It is one thing to preach black power, quite another to practice it successfully. Richard Threlkeld, CBS News, Oakland, California.
They boast about what they have and what they will deprive us of. I say the earth belongs to the black man. There was not one square foot of earth given to the white race.
Among those attending the convention were Muhammad Ali, former heavyweight champion, who was Cassius Clay before his conversion into the sect.
How did he bring all of us together? Look at all these beautiful, clean sisters. No powder, no paint, just everywhere. How can he, with a third grade education, style up something? All of these black people here, not one cigarette in your pockets, no alcohol on your breath, no men winking and patting at other women. That's a miracle for so-called Negroes. And now they want to put me in jail because I follow this lovely, sweet man. I tell them they can clean out my cell and take me to jail because I never denounce this man.
Muhammad Ali looked like he was training for a title fight. He was up before dawn and off to Houston's Memorial Park for an hour-long workout that included shadow boxing and 3 miles of running. He does this 3 times a week, he says, to keep the mind clear. The 25-year-old deposed world boxing champion says while he's not working out, he spends 160 hours a month as a black Muslim minister. He hardly looked like the defendant in a court fight that could result in a 5-year prison term. Now, champ, you're up against another kind of fight, one that isn't in the ring. How do you feel about that? Do you think you can go the full term?
Well, we can always go the full term in a court or in the boxing ring, but don't necessarily mean we'll win the decision. And so we just hope and pray to Allah that we can come out victorious. And I'm sure if there is some justice left here in the country, America, and if there is a little justice left, it will be prevailed in the courts.
Ali's lawyers preceded him to the U.S. District Court, where an all-white jury is trying him. After the defense and state rested their cases, the defense moved for acquittal on 6 grounds, including the arguments that Ali is a minister and that Negroes are systematically excluded from local draft boards. The state's case is based on Ali's refusal to be inducted by the Army. Is the fact that there are no Negroes on the jury of any concern to you?
No, color means nothing when it comes to justice. Whether they be black, green, or blue, if justice prevails, justice is justice. I mean, color means nothing.
For the jury of 6 men and 6 women, it will be a decision as to whether Muhammad Ali is, in fact, a black Muslim minister, therefore eligible for deferment. Their other choice is that, as the government contends, Ali, the boxer, failed to step forward.
North of the New York most visitors know, up above where the trains come out of the Park Avenue tunnel, beyond the grimy greenness of Upper Central Park. This is Central Harlem and 117th Street between Lenox and 7th Avenues.
Everybody's talking about Harlem. Harlem is the place for me. Everybody's talking about Harlem. I'm gonna stay here till eternity. I can't live in the...
It's a block reasonably representative of the 3.5 square miles and 251 street corners where more than 210,000 Negroes live in the nation's biggest black ghetto. Tonight, we'll get to know that block. It's quite a block.
Keep it in Harlem, don't mean me no good. Let the fuss and fight drive me in my own neighborhood. But everybody's talking about Harlem. Harlem is the place for me. Everybody's talking about Harlem.
This is a CBS News special report. 117th Street, New York, New York. Here is CBS News correspondent Harry Reasoner.
Harlem is a name that means a city community where Negroes live, as well as a specific place in New York City. So when trouble started in Harlem 11 days ago, it was reasonable to fear that it might be a pattern for the long-expected trouble from the Negro North. Last week, in the first part of an attempt to understand that possible pattern, the mood and temper of Harlem, we broadcast a wide variety of views of leaders of Harlem. This week, CBS News correspondent Charles Kuralt has spent on one block of Harlem. Because patterns of fear and trouble start with individuals, and sometimes individuals get lost in big surveys. Last Saturday, there was no repeat engagement of the previous weekend's Harlem riots. There were plenty of police around, but not really a lot for them to do. There was, finally, organized and effective encouragement for people to stay at home.
Our community, that we might have it, and perpetually so, do not become involved in any of the demonstrations this afternoon. You and your children, your husbands, your fathers, your mothers, your sisters, your wives, everybody, clear the streets this afternoon, lest you become involved in this great altercation.
The only people out hoping for trouble were from the bitter side of Negro protest, the people who put out posters accusing policemen of murder, the people who urge violence. On Saturday, they tried briefly and without much support to start a protest march they had been told they could not have. The police stopped them easily because no substantial group of Harlem residents supported them. This was just a little eddy at the end of the big excitement. It took place on Lenox Avenue, and it brushed our block, 117th Street off Lenox, where Charles Kuralt was getting to know the people.
People who come from towns where the streets are named Oak or Maple or Main are always disturbed by the cold, anonymous sound of New York street names. It's true that 117th isn't exactly the most romantic or imaginative name for a street, but you shouldn't conclude from that 117th Street is just a line on the crosstown grid of Manhattan. This block between Lenox and 7th is as interesting and varied as your block, wherever you live. There's a grocery store, Mrs. Hobson's. Mrs. Hobson threw no bottles in the riot last week. We thought you might like to meet her and her son. This block has a couple of churches. A lot of people on 117th Street go to church. It has a political club, which is really a drinking club. A lot of people on 117th Street drink. It has, this one block has, about 3,000 people. There are as many differences among them as among any 3,000 people anywhere. They have one thing in common. They are all black. All except Dr. Wolf, the dentist here on the corner. He opened his practice here years ago when this block was interracial, and he's just stayed. There may be one or two others like him. So, the people on 117th, between 7th and Lenox, are almost all black. And almost all poor. Some very poor, and almost all dissatisfied, some miserable. But like a depressing small town, 117th Street still exerts its pull on people. They call themselves 17th Streeters, and even those who grew up here and moved away often come back. CBS News reporter Ben Holman and I, in talking to people on this block after the riots, found a number just back for a visit. One of those was Richard Herbert, who lives in the Bronx now. The reason for the riots, he said, was roughly the same reason he moved away.
As a youngster here on this block, what are some of the things that you saw?
As a youngster on 17th Street, I saw prostitution, dope peddling, number racketeers, every vice you can think of that's corrupted.
Why did these things go on here?
Because young men, 18, 17, 20, went downtown looking for jobs with high school diplomas, $35 a week. Fellows with college degrees at $75 a week, which is wrong. They couldn't support a family on it. Two kids, a family to take care of. So they stooped to the next lowest thing, the quick dollar. $150 a week, pushing numbers, selling dope. Fast dollar, something to take care of a family.
Why couldn't they get jobs?
Because the white man downtown said they weren't qualified.
Well, they had high school educations. Why weren't they qualified?
Because they were black.
Did the record have anything to do with it?
Yes, some records, as far as being locked up for pushing numbers, pushing dope, and they weren't given a second chance. I mean, if you commit a crime, I feel that 5 years after you committed a crime, if you've lived a normal, decent life after a period of 5 years, You should be given a chance, second opportunity, to face life, society, and be something in this world. So your children can grow up and look at you and say, well, this is my father. He was wrong when he grew up, but today he's my father. He's accomplished something in life. He's part of society. That's all we want. We just want to be recognized. Give us a fighting chance. Don't condemn us because we sell dope or we steal. There's a reason for it. You say we ride. Yes, we ride and loot, but that's the explanation. The explanation for that is the fact that we don't have enough high-paying jobs. They won't give us a salary, the decent salary. I know they condemn the dope addict, say, well, he's no good. But why is he no good? There's a reason for him doing this. He's depressed. He can't find a decent-paying job, something to bring money to bring home to his family. So he goes for the quickest dollar. And you can't condemn the man for trying to take care of his family, for trying to be something. You go all around the world, and you come right back here to Harlem. It's the same thing. We just haven't been given a chance, a decent chance, a fighting chance. That's all we ask for, is equality. We don't want to be like you. We just want a fighting chance to say that we can take off a weekend, go fishing, go hunting, go downtown to a decent movie, enjoy life, have all the other luxuries in life that we should have, that the next man has.
One of this block's many have-nots is Edmund Woods. The things he has are an education, self-taught, a lingering illness, and a pervasive dislike of policemen.
Has there been much of a change in the personnel of the policemen assigned to this area recently?
Oh, they have changed policemen, but the attitude of the police hasn't changed in the least.
Have they assigned many Negro policemen to this block?
No.
None at all?
Hey, a few over a period of years, I have seen Negro policemen assigned to this block, but none steady. None of them stayed any length of time. And they stay a while and they go. But none of them, I can't say that I know any Negro policeman by his name was assigned to this block.
Well, do you get along better with the Negro policeman than the white?
Well, it seems to be more communication, because things that I might be reluctant to say to a white policeman, I might say to a Negro policeman, and things that a Negro policeman might say to me that I would resent a white man saying, I won't resent him saying.
What about the recent rioting here in Harlem and in this area?
Well, I think that has been overplayed. First of all, they call it a riot. Mayor Wagner, he flew back from Europe. He said, it's been a riot. The Negro needs law and order. What is this, a sword of Damocles hanging over our heads? The students, every summer, you pick up the paper, you see in St. Augustine, Florida, that 2,000, 3,000 students, they have a fight on the beach. They fight policemen. They throw beer bottles and everything. So they say, oh, those are just college kids. So these are just kids, people with no hope, lethargic, been having paternalism all their lives, not having no hope for tomorrow, not knowing where half of the time where the next meal is coming from. They're tired of the whole thing, more or less, and they just let off a little steam. That's all. They didn't harm anyone. They didn't try to, it wasn't a race riot. If there were any fatalities, the fatalities were among the black man, not among the white men, not among the policemen. The policemen were supposed to be shooting in the air, so they claim, but I saw a man get shot in his buttocks, and if the policeman was shooting in the air, the man would have to be 150 feet tall. Or the bullet must have ricocheted off a cloud or something.
There is a silent, undeclared war between 117th Street and the police. There has been since long before the Harlem riots. Whether true or not, it is an article of belief among many people in this block that white policemen take pleasure in swinging billy clubs at black heads. And when patrolmen walk this block, they are surrounded by a sullen silence. The police, for their part, know this block is a center for street sales of narcotics. Addicts come here even from other parts of New York to await their connection and buy their fix. The police say 117th is a fairly bad street, 117th says the police take money to look away from narcotics, gambling, and petty crime. Or at least, that's what most people say. There's nothing monolithic about people or their opinions in this block. And if it is a bad block, as the police think of it, that is not the fault of people like Mrs. Willie Mae Anderson. Mrs. Anderson, like many other 17th Streeters, has other things to think about besides the police. She's concerned mostly with finding occasional work for herself. She works downtown in White Manhattan as a part-time maid. Sometimes she sells ice cream in the street when there's no work to be had downtown. Mrs. Anderson is well-liked by her neighbors, and she's depended upon by her family, a son, a daughter-in-law, and a granddaughter, and another son who just moved up from Macon, Georgia, to join her in her railroad flat, four small walk-through rooms lined up like boxcars, at 136 West 117th, in the middle of this block. All five Andersons live together in the apartment. They pay $62 a month rent, and Mrs. Anderson thinks that's too much, considering that the apartment has rats and roaches. When a white policeman shot a Negro boy and touched off rioting in Harlem and created huge headlines around the world, Mrs. Anderson and her family stayed indoors until the storm of anger passed.
Mrs. Anderson, you've lived on this block for 10 years, you say. There's been a lot of talk here about the police. What do you think about it?
Oh, they're much needed, the police. Without the police protection, I would want to live in the city.
A lot of people here on the block say that they fear the police.
I don't know about the fear, because I've always been a law-abiding citizen, and I haven't had any contact with the police. And I believe the ones that are talking about the police all the time, they don't want to abide by the law.
What do you think about all the rioting against the police?
Well, I don't think it was necessary, because they didn't have to go on like that. Seemingly, they were all up for stealing more than there was about concern of the boy.
Mrs. Anderson's view of the riot is shared by her son, Furman, who is 25 years old. He's the son who's a new arrival from the South, like so many of the people in Harlem, like so many on this block of 117th Street. He is on 117th, but not yet a part of it. Furman Anderson is still holding on to his hope for something better.
Mr. Anderson, how long have you been here in New York City?
3 weeks now. 3 weeks. I've been in New York 3 weeks now.
Why did you leave your home in Georgia to come here?
Well, I'm looking for better work. That's why I'm here, to look for better work. Because work done run out in my hometown.
You say work had run out in your hometown?
Run out, well, it's kind of hard to get a job, but I mean.
What kind of qualifications or experience do they ask for when you apply for a job here?
Well, just ask for the job, what you have did, mostly. See, most of the job I was doing there, I did construction work. And I also worked at the Dempsey Hotel in Macon. The Dempsey Hotel, and I worked when I was coming up for a grocery store when I was a boy going to school. I was going to school, and I worked for him every afternoon.
What about the people that you've met here on 117th Street? How do they compare with the people back home?
Well, you walk past them and speak to them. Someone won't speak to you back. I don't know. I guess that was the way I was brought up, to speak when I pass people. But you walk past them here and speak, they won't speak back. I don't know. I don't go out too much on the street.
Why don't you go out very much on the streets here?
Well, I saw a little incident the other day out on the streets, and I always rather be inside. There's different things going out in the streets. I stay on in.
What sort of things go on the street that you're talking about?
Well, such as gambling, all the time they fighting, robbing, all that. I see it go on in the streets.
What do you look forward to as a future here in Harlem?
I believe it's a quieter neighborhood somewhere around. I would like to move my mother away from around it, because the fellas walk, they don't have no respect. They cuss all day. They out there gambling all that night. in front of her. So I would like to get her in a more quieter neighborhood.
You leave Furman Anderson and his mother in their railroad flat, hoping he does find a job, and hoping he does leave 117th Street, since that's what he wants so much to do. Some people have managed it, but usually on the basis of some special knowledge or ability, which of course Furman Anderson doesn't have. All he has is his hope.
If you begin to get a little tall, I ought to pack up my things and haul. I know a dollar goes from hand to hand before I let you go from man to man. I'd rather drink muddy water, sleep in a hollow log. One thing, baby, I can't understand. How come you ain't satisfied with one man? How can you love me and say that you're true? How can you love me and my best friend too? I'd rather drink muddy water, sleep in a hollow log.
117th Street does have its diversions, and one of them is a street band that comes through every day or two. The songs it performs on the stoop are all up-tempo, but they're still the blues.
One of the worst feelings that a poor man has ever had. Now if you got a good woman, take everywhere you go. If you got a good woman, take her everywhere you go. Cause a good woman's hard to find and you can't find them no more. If you begin to get a little tall.
It's astonishing how many people earn a kind of living off 117th in spite of its poverty. The fruit peddler, who has vanished from the rest of New York, still shows up here. So does the snowball man, who shaves a cake of ice and pours flavor on the shavings. You can't get a job without qualifications, one man said, and another answered, I'm qualified. I can shave ice. And even the junk man still comes to 117th.
But the blues ain't nothing but a good man feeling bad. Well, the blues ain't nothing but a good man feeling bad. One of the worst old feelings that a poor man has ever had. Now if you got a good woman, take her everywhere you go. If you got a good woman...
There are kids in this block of 117th Street who will spend all summer proving who can throw a bottle cap closest to a front step. There are adults in the block who will spend all summer looking for sevens and rolling threes. But the ultimate diversion of 117th is back in the alley, the white powder and the blunt needle. You can buy half a load of heroin on this block for $1,000 if you've got that much, or a four-hour fix for $3 if you've got that much, and buy your happiness that way, as long as your veins hold out. Just in case you find this colorful or stimulating in any way, you ought to meet Mrs. Beatrice Jones. She lives over there at number 139 on the third floor. She's lived here for a long time, and she's sick of the blues, sick of the junk man's wagon and the junkie's needle and the crap games on the sidewalk. She's sick of 117th Street. And unlike Furman Anderson, she has children. Especially for their sake, she's been searching for a way to get out.
Mrs. Jones, what schools do your sons go to?
Well, they were both in public school 184, which is an all-Negro school. There are a few smatterings of around of Puerto Rican children, but on a whole, they're all Negro. And I requested, as I said, when my older boy graduated in June, that he be sent to PS Public School 80, which I understand is in the Bronx, that's an integrated school. And they sent these applications out for us to fill out. And when they were returned, No one got any consideration as to the school that they wanted the children to go to. Consequently, my son still has to go to Cooper, which is still an all-Negro school.
Well, what was wrong with the elementary school that he was attending?
Well, you know, a lot of people don't think that elementary school is important, you know, where the Negro children are concerned. It's a place to send them to get them off of the streets for 6 or 7 hours. I mean, that's the conclusion that I've drawn from it. And the fact that they passed, a lot of them passed. You know, it's surprising that some of the children can't even spell that come out of these Harlem schools. They can't spell. And it isn't that their parents aren't trying, because I know some who work in the post office, their fathers, and that they're on the, they have civil service jobs, and they try for their children, but they're just not learning anything in these schools.
What about the teachers in those schools? Have you had a chance to meet them?
Oh, I've met each and every one of them. Each and every one. And I guess they do what they can with what they have, which is not very much.
And the discipline in the school, how's that?
I think the majority of them are afraid. Are afraid. I mean, they don't discipline the children anymore. They're afraid. You know, it's gotten so that the children, I mean, they don't, they aren't disciplined like they used to be, you know? It seems as if they said, oh, I don't care, you know, you're not going to do anything to me, or you're not going to bother me. And some of them get promoted just so the teachers can get rid of them. That's the truth. Whereas if they were really learning anything, you know, if they were interested in what they were being taught, let's put it that way, that they wouldn't have a chance to be so rude, you know? And a lot of these children, their parents are not even home to supervise them. A lot of them are working. They don't have any place to play. They're in the streets all day long, you know? And it's very bad. There's nothing in the street that's gonna teach them anything except bad habits.
After school, here in the home environment, what can your sons do?
Nothing. They have games. They watch television. But remember, they're 11 and 12. You can't keep them in the house all day. And where can they play?
What happens when they leave the house and come out into the street here?
Well, they're just out here. They're just out here, that's all. You don't really know. They can't go to the show every day. They have the usual things. They have skates. They have bicycles. But then what else? That's all.
What goes on around them when they're out here playing in the street?
Everything. They're shooting crap, they're using dope, they're alcoholics out here, they're winos. I mean, it's all around them. It's all around them.
During the recent riots and street fightings in this area, what were you doing?
I was in my house with my windows closed.
You're very frightened by it all?
Scared to death. At one period there, I really thought that 117th Street was going to be, you know, passed over with that mess. And then, of course, there were a couple of rowdies who came on the scene, and that was it. That one particular night, they had to get the cops in 117th Street. I was hoping that we would be passed over. But that one particular night, some idiot decided, well, I'll throw a bottle at the policeman, and that was it. But on a whole, this was not a bad area during that riot. It was on Lenox and on 7th, but I don't think it was actually hit on 17th Street.
How do you feel about all the rioting and
terrible.
Fighting back?
Terrible. Very bad. I don't think that we'll ever gain anything by that. Never.
Have you made any effort to try to move away from this?
Oh, yes. I applied to the projects for the last 4 years, and I was finally accepted. So I felt that now at least my son will go to another school.
We'll continue our visit on 117th Street in a moment, after this pause for station identification.
About 117th Street between 7th Avenue and Lenox Avenue, we haven't mentioned yet, and that is that it is falling apart. Too many people in too few rooms for too long, and the rooms are collapsing around them. Some 17th Streeters try to keep their apartments up, some do not. It doesn't really matter very much. The houses are so old, all of them built in the last century, and most of them are in such bad repair that everybody in the block has to live with holes in the plaster and roaches on the walls. The courtyard behind this block is even worse than the crumbling facade in front. The United States Bureau of the Census has labeled 49% of the housing of Harlem officially deteriorating or dilapidated. 117th Street has a little higher percentage than that. The block is simply a prison of rusting metal and rotting brick. The tenants who live in the prison are powerless, most of them, to break out of it. The landlords who might improve it cannot or will not. Banks will not lend money for renovation of such buildings, of course. And some landlords themselves have gone broke on 117th Street and let the city take over their property and board it up. The piles of garbage are particularly high around the buildings the city is responsible for. Ben Holman talked with tenant James McCoy.
This condition has been neglected. It's long overdue that somebody, I feel, should take a more serious interest. After all, we are taxpayers. We work for a living. Many of us work for a living. Many of us, I repeat, work for a living in spite of what you might read about in the papers. I happen to be an employee of the New York City Transit Authority, have been for some 18 years. So I am one of the working people in this block. But along with that, there are many other people in this block that work and would like to contribute to the betterment of Harlem and New York City with the help of some of the city officials pertaining to housing. I mention housing because housing is terrible on this street.
Well, how bad are conditions here?
You ask me how bad are conditions here. Well, conditions here are terrible, sir. If anybody interested would examine the backyards of 132, 134, you'll find garbage about 5 feet high. Now, surely conditions such as that make it just about impossible to live in this neighborhood. That is my complaint. I have personally made a complaint to the building department of New York City about my particular apartment. As a matter of fact, an inspector has visited my home. After complaining to the inspector remarked to me, "Mr. McCoy, your apartment is in pretty bad condition, but it looks a little better than most people's apartments." That doesn't help the situation any, not at all.
It was an act of providence that the 19th century architects put outside steps on uptown Manhattan buildings. Otherwise, Harlem would have no place to sit down. The overcrowding and the unemployment mean that many 17th Streeters have nothing to do but sit and talk until the numbers runner comes by. And after that, sit and talk until dark. And after that, sit and talk until bedtime. All children play cops and robbers. The unsettling difference on this block is that without a doubt, some children will grow up to play cops and robbers for real. All these things are disturbing to the old-time residents of 117th Street. They can remember when there weren't so many stoop sitters, when the nice families kept their children off the streets, and they are proud to be nice families still. One such person is Mrs. Alma Hobson. Old resident though she is, her views are not old-fashioned. She disapproved of the rioting, for example, but mainly on the grounds it was in the wrong place. If they were going to riot, she thinks, it should have been downtown in the white neighborhoods. Mrs. Hobson came to Harlem as a child from Charleston, South Carolina, and for 19 years she has been the proprietor of Hobson's Community Pure Food Center down at the Lenox Avenue end of the block. She doesn't own the store building, but she does own the display cases and the stock, and she keeps the store neat and orderly on the inside. During the rioting, she carefully locked up the store and went home. Mrs. Hobson lives across the street from her store at number 124 West 117th, and it was there that her son Ernest grew up. He is a state parole officer now, and in some ways, the block's outstanding success.
This has always been a neighborhood of vice. 20 years since 1941, the area here was a red light district. This block has also been used as a center for policy, which meant that there was the tie-up between the gang lords from Little Italy, which is half a dozen blocks away, and so that the police became either through their cooperation with the gambling and the racketeers have gotten in a custom of looking away or looking the other side or not seeing.
Is there any hope for 117th Street?
Yes, there's hope for 117th Street. There's hope for all the areas here. But the hope must come first from the people themselves. The decent people of the community must make a stand.
Well, exactly how could people take a stand? Surely rioting in the street isn't the kind of stand you mean.
Well, these conditions have been going on a long time. We've had only one or two riots. This goes on every day. They have sufficient police now to man the corners with flying squads. Yet the condition that prevail here on a day-to-day basis, they can't get one cop to stand one block to disperse a gambling game that's not only setting a bad example for the kids growing up, but is also used to pass drugs, used for the sale of drugs. One cop standing here in this block doing his job as he's supposed to do on a day-to-day basis, the 365 days a year, not the one or two nights that they had the rioting, would have done a whole lot to prevent the causes that brought up the rioting. But now I wonder about City Hall, that they could sit up an army of policemen, occupy the area, and when we asked last year for a single cop to make this a special post to stop the gambling in the streets and to keep the drugs out of 117th Street, we couldn't get two cops on a 24-hour basis to prevent crime. But yet, when the rioting come, they got an army of cops to spare. I don't put all the blame on the police department. I put the rest of the blame on the people in the community, because it's their responsibility to see that the cops do their job. Because when you walk out here and see your kid being influenced by crap shooters, drug addicts, and etc., and you go in and close your door like it doesn't exist, you're just as guilty as the man who eventually put a bag of drugs in your kid's hand when you should have done something about it to begin with.
Ernest Hobson, whose mother sells groceries to 17th Streeters, has revoked the parole of a number of his neighbors. He's universally respected on this block, but naturally enough, he's not universally liked. The most popular man on the block is probably Donald Rogers. He was brought up at number 140, and it was on a stoop just a couple of doors from there that Ben Holman found him, surrounded, as always, by friends. Donald Rogers reflects so many opinions widely held in Harlem that we found ourselves listening to him for quite a long time. As we said in the beginning, people on 117th Street are many and varied, and nobody is the authentic voice of this block, but Don Rogers comes close.
You know, in most communities, people look upon the policeman as their friend, their protectors. Don't the people of Harlem look upon the policeman in that manner?
Well, the policeman in Harlem is not the people's protector. He is a man just like the rest, exploits the people and takes advantage of them. You know, they gouges the people like.
Well, when you walk down the street and you see a policeman walking his beat or standing on a corner, what do you think about him? What do you think of him?
I see a fellow that I have more fear for the police than I have for the criminal. Because the policeman can do it and get away with it. I can fight the criminal back. You follow me? If I was being robbed, I could fight the guy, the robber. But what am I going to do with the policeman? You follow me? I have no win there.
Well, have you had any personal experience where police, you think, took advantage of you?
Well, I can recall an incident when we were walking down the street and we were moving a television from one apartment to another for a friend, doing a friend a favor. It was his television, he was with me, and the policeman called us to the side and asked us where we're going, where we're coming from, and so my friend resented the policeman, more like questioning him about the television, and asked him, what's the matter? Ain't he supposed to have a television? He says, no, a nigga ain't supposed to have nothing.
Whom do you think are the leaders of Harlem?
Well, in Harlem, I say that the black Muslims were the leaders. That's what I'd say.
You think they're the leaders of Harlem now?
Well, they seem to be more for the people than anybody else. Because if you watch them, you can see improvement. But you don't see improvement no other kind of way. But when you look at a Muslim, you see a man that you can respect as a person. And when you talk with one, he demands your respect because he always says, sir, to you. What can you say to him but sir?
But do you think an organization, or do you think the black Muslims are doing more for Harlem, say, than an old organization like the NAACP?
Well, the black Muslims reaches the people more so than the NAACP. You see, now your NAACP officials, the bigger ones, we don't never see them. They don't understand our problem, I don't think, because they're never here. You got to be with the people to understand the people. You can't be down there on 42nd Street and understand the situation on 116th or 117th Street. Do you understand what I'm trying to say?
One of the NAACP officials said recently that if Malcolm X were to try to lead Negroes from the United States to some other land, he wouldn't get 10 to follow him. Is this official
wrong?
Well,
I disagree with him. I'd say this. Malcolm X has more guts than all of them put together, because Malcolm X has the guts to say what he wants to say, what they want to say, but they won't say because of their positions. You see, when a Negro works for white people, he can't speak his mind like he wants to because he jeopardizes his position. And I can go along with him and understand him for the simple reason he's got a family and things to take care of. He's got to have bread, and this is his way and his source because this is the white man's country. So he's got to go along with these things. He doesn't even express himself like he wants to when he's in these positions. And I understand why. Because of the necessities of life. But now, like people like Malcolm X, who is not associated with white people, they can say the things they want to say. And the things that they say hold a lot of truth.
Do you think the race problem then is essentially a problem of the Negroes being able to speak up and say what they want to say?
No, that's not only the problem. The problem is the white people accepting Negro people as human beings. That's the whole problem. See, what the white people did to us, they don't want to be sorry for it. It's like an ignorant person who says, I'm wrong, but so what? Now, the white people know the way they treat the Negro definitely is wrong, but they got a so what attitude about it.
Well, it's practically nothing but Negroes here in Harlem. What's wrong with Harlem?
Well, when you throw a bunch of poor people together, what do you think you're going to have? Everybody is hungry. What do you think you're going to have? Throw a bunch of mad dogs together, what results you get? They're going to eat each other, right?
You know, white folks always talk about the crime in Harlem. What about the crime in Harlem?
What do you expect for it to be in Harlem? Sure, it's going to be crime in Harlem. The policeman don't try to stop the crime. He adds to the crime when he accepts the money from people in graft.
Thank you.
If he would do his job, it would be less crime. But Harlem is a place that's being exploited by everybody, not only by the policeman, by the bondsman, by the lawyer, and everybody else. More of the Negroes' dollars go to lawyers, bondsmen, and policemen than any other source. They pay more dollars to them than they do for food. You just look at the court building and see who all's down there. Just go into the jails and see who all in there. It's a situation where the police have no respect at all for the people. Like in other words, the people are supposed to have respect for the police, or the people themselves are due some sort of consideration as people. But they're not treated as people. They're treated as something other than people. Like, I can recall an incident even like last night. Well, after all the riots and the different little, you know, incidents, well, the police were a little tense and whatnot. But now, last night was kind of a warm night. We were all sitting around, you know, standing on the stoops and things of that sort. And we were told to leave, to go away. Well, some fellas said, well, officer, it was kind of hot and we didn't want to go, you know, home at this particular time. We just, you know, just spending a little time, you know, sitting on the sidewalk. It was an early hour, about 10:30, 11 o'clock, and we were told to get out, move. But where you want us to go, you know? They just tell you to keep going, you keep going. Where are you going to go?
Where are you going to go if you live on 117th Street? We heard so many complaints against the police in Harlem that we asked CBS News reporter Sam Roberts to put them to New York's Deputy Police Commissioner, Walter Arm.
Commissioner, there are claims in New York City that the police department here has a double standard of justice. There's one standard for the Negroes in Harlem and Bedford-Stuyvesant and one standard for the whites. What does the police department think?
Well, I'd like to emphasize as strongly as possible that these claims are unfounded. The function of the police, which they will carry out fully, is to make certain that there is equal justice and equal protection for everyone in this city.
Well, these claims state that aside from the riots, in normal conditions in the Negro neighborhoods, police are free and easy with the use of clubs, for instance.
We deny it, and we say that anyone that has any information that, to that respect, should make their complaint, an allegation to the Civilian Complaint Review Board of this department, where it will be fully and thoroughly and impartially investigated.
Commissioner, what about these charges that during the riots police shot indiscriminately into crowds and not over their heads?
Well, in any case of a direct firing into crowds, as alleged, I only have to point to the low casualty list in the five horrible days that we experienced to show that there was only one dead and only a certain number of injured, many and most of them not from bullets, but from bricks and bottles.
Now, what about the feeling of the people who live in Harlem about the police force? There are claims that policemen know of graft, of vice going on, of gambling, that they don't bother with the dope addicts. What does the police department say about this?
Well, we say that if anyone has any information of this type, we'd like to have it and take the necessary action that would be indicated. We'd also like to point out that there are reasons why gambling does go on, why there is narcotic trade in Harlem. It's because the people in that area and a lot of other areas insist on gambling, and many of them are victims of the narcotics habit. We are not after the gambler, nor are we after the poor addict. We are after the higher-ups, the suppliers. We're after the bankers in the policy business. We're after the big shots. This cannot be done just by sweeping people off the street who will return to that street tomorrow. It takes long, careful investigation. And what we try to do is get at the source of supply in the narcotics business and cut it off.
Commissioner, are you yourself satisfied with the way the police handled the whole situation this past week?
Again, the word satisfied. We're never satisfied. We hoped that something like this would not happen. We are disheartened that it did happen. We feel bad that action had to be taken to break up violence. But we feel that this was incumbent upon this department and that we must meet force with force to contain and protect the people of that community and any other community, and we'll continue to fulfill our job.
But where are you going to go if you live on 117th Street? In spite of all the official concern for law and order, that remains the question. And Dr. Kenneth Clark, the New York City College psychologist and sociologist, has an answer. If you live in Harlem, you're going nowhere.
Do you think any good can come out of this kind of violence in the streets?
No, I don't think that good ever comes out of violence as such. Violence is a symptom of the absence of good. Violence is a symptom of horror. Violence is a symptom of social disease, prejudice, discrimination. And I don't think that any good is going to come out of this, because after our elected officials, our police authorities, quiet this violence down, and they will, and they will probably put in more police to keep these people under control, all of the abuses that existed in Harlem before the violence will continue to exist. Out of this upheaval probably will not come even the attempt to get a single street more clean than it was before. Out of this will probably not come the attempt to get a decent school where there was none before. You know, what we will have is what we had after the 43 riots. Business as usual.
People on the streets in Harlem think now the city government is going to sit up and take notice of us. You think they're going to be disappointed?
Well, I suppose the people always have to have hope. And maybe it'll be good if they believe this. If the future follows the course of the past, this will be another hope that will be shattered for these people. I personally, as a student of these problems, have no hope that the city government will really be any more concerned about these people now than they were before. If they were concerned, we wouldn't have the combustible ingredients for these riots that we have.
Is there really no answer for the boy on 117th Street? Surely throwing a rock through a clothing store window isn't any kind of answer.
No, it's not going to help him to throw a brick through a window. Throwing a brick through a window merely gets him deeper and deeper in the prison. And instead of having the prison of his community, he will have the literal prison before him. But this is the real devastating thing about Harlem today. The young people, as I've seen them, don't believe that anything is going to help them. Too many of them, for seemingly good reasons, have lost faith in the possibility of help.
As high as you can go on 117th Street is to the fifth floor rooftops. Up there you can keep pigeons, or read a book, or make love, or occasionally be alone if that's what you want, but you cannot go higher. The pigeons can fly away, but the people stay here. Their block is no better than some other blocks in Harlem and no worse than some, but it's their block and there's no escape for most of them. For their children, it could be different. The children learning the small things we all learned, M-I-S-S-I-S-S-I-P-P-I, the children too young for irony. If white New York wonders why there were riots in Harlem, here may be the beginning of an answer. That one generation of Harlem youth threw bottles at the white police in 1943 and nothing changed. That another generation threw bottles at the police last week. And that a single boy, who belongs to still another generation, went wandering this afternoon in the backyard of 117th Street, aimlessly, through a clutter and debris that he did nothing to create.
A good many of the questions raised by the stories of the people on 117th Street must be answered, if they can be answered, by the city of New York, which is why we're here with Mayor Robert Wagner. Mayor Wagner, there was a tone of hopelessness in what we've heard tonight. Is this a justified hopelessness? Is there any chance for the people of Harlem?
Well, there's no question about it, Mr. Reisner, that many of these people feel hopeless and frustrated. They haven't the opportunities that others have. They live in conditions that certainly don't warrant a good deal of enthusiasm about getting ahead, and feel that nobody really cares about them. But I don't feel they should be that hopeless. Things have been done over the years, And things are being done, and lots more must be done to give them an idea that they, somebody is concerned about them, their government is concerned, the city and state, federal governments, and also that they give them the opportunity of climbing out of the well into the sunlight. And that has been our objective. Now, many of these things take a good long while, and to try to make up the frustrations and mistakes of the many years cannot be done overnight. I certainly am one of those who feel a good deal must be done to step up our programs in job opportunities, in better housing, better educational opportunities. In the area there, as well as many of the other so-called deprived areas, we have many new housing projects. As a matter of fact, our housing program here in the city, low-cost housing program, is practically larger than all of the other housing programs throughout the country combined. And yet, we still have many people living in very bad conditions. In the area of job opportunities, we have set up through JOIN, which is consolidation with the federal government to help train youngsters. We have education second chance there to give people an opportunity to get basic education so that they then can get off the welfare rolls and get a job. Reason they couldn't get a job before is they lacked that basic educational training. And we do know that we must train particularly the young people for jobs that are available. And we must, of course, increase the quality of education, particularly in some of these areas, as exemplified by 117th Street, to see that those schools are brought up in the level. And this is the object, of course, of the Board of Education, too, so that those youngsters there will be getting the same education as other youngsters throughout the city.
Some people say that the only time the city administration notices Harlem is after something violent like last week. Is that...
Well, I think the light of public attention is focused on it, on an area like Harlem and the problems that they have there. But as mentioned, all these programs, they have been going on for a number of years, and one thing we would like to have is more money available to do. We work on all these programs. It's the HIU Act program, which is going to be a great help to train a lot of the youngsters with the community participating in its function. And therefore, we're deeply concerned about the passage of the President's anti-poverty bill. We're all ready with our programs to move in to take advantage of the funds that will come from that passage of that bill. We have money set aside in our own budget for the matching funds. And of course, we've had to progress on our own with our limited amount of money in some of these training programs and aids to fight the poverty. Up to now. I think this is going to be a shot in the arm for us, and we're ready to move ahead. Now, all of these things have been planned, worked on, initiated, put into operation well before any of the disturbances took part last week. But they do focus attention for the general public on the problems there and conditions.
Were you satisfied with the performance of the police department during the riots? Do you believe that they handled them as efficiently and as bloodlessly as possible?
Well, I think everyone agrees that the police department did an exceptionally fine job. Some have had experience in the past. Many of the younger policemen have never had this experience before, and I think everyone's very proud of the way their restraint and their discipline and the way the trouble was contained, and that we have peace at this time, which we hope can continue in the future, and give some hope to many of the people, of course, who didn't participate at all, the hope that we've been talking about here. I would say that the praise for them has been generally throughout the whole city.
Thank you very much, sir.
All the scenes in this program were filmed during the last 5 days in Harlem, and the interview with Mayor Wagner was done on videotape this morning at his residence, Gracie Mansion. Tonight, the leaders of the nation's 6 major civil rights organizations asked their people to suspend major demonstrations and picketing until after the presidential elections. to concentrate in the emotional weeks ahead on voter registration campaigns rather than pressing in the streets. It may be that this decision and Mayor Wagner's feeling that there is hope for the youngsters of Harlem and our look at 117th Street have a dual thread in common. One strand of the thread is the realization that the riots bring that our society is a fragile thing depending on the support of its members, and that an area like 117th Street is not far from completely withholding that support. Where that happens, there are just not enough police. The other strand of the thread is the awareness of some of the people on 117th Street that things can be better, are better, in fact, for people on other blocks right in Harlem, and can be even better than that. It is possible to say that among some of the people we've met tonight, their dissatisfaction is a measure of the strength of their aspirations, a feeling that for the first time in civilized history, a nation has the chance, and has gone on record as saying it has the desire, to make a multiracial society where there is real equality. If that could happen, you might, oddly enough, look back sometime on 117th Street between Lenox and 7th in the heat of 1964 as an historic place. This is Harry Reasoner. Good night.
This has been the CBS News Special Report. 117th Street, New York, New York. This program has been produced under the...
La ilaha illallah. Hayya 'alan falah. Hayya 'ala salah.
Any increased voter registration is a plus. And the fact that the Nation of Islam will bring into the political arena a disciplined group of registered voters means it will have even more impact. The Nation of Islam's influence goes beyond the realm of its direct membership. To that extent, you will have a tremendous influence. Certainly, it will discourage the notion that we experienced in 1968 of don't vote or why vote, or there's a futility in voting.
Now let us get busy right here and build this new world, and I assure you we won't be ruled by any other self. Government in the new world. Assalamu alaikum.
There are some who say that there is an inconsistency between the initial rejection of Malcolm X by the Nation of Islam and now the apparent redemption of Malcolm in the renaming of the temple in New York in his honor. Do you find an inconsistency there at all?
No, sir, no indeed.
Why?
There is a consistency because it is an evolutionary change which brings the community that did know that Malcolm was the builder, or you know, the primary cause of building mosque number 7, and those that knew that he worked very hard and they see the mosque being named after him, they actually, you know, we'll see the justice that the Honorable Wallace D. Muhammad is bringing, you know, to surface. Now, what I see in the move that the Honorable Wallace D. Muhammad is making is that he is actually giving credit where credit is due. And this is something that it takes a great amount of courage and a man of great love for truth in order to do that. So I see that this is a very positive thing, and it's actually taking away the things that many people were actually against in coming into the nation.
Brother Clyde, what about the year of change? How is it affected the rank and file members of the Nation of Islam, the acceptance of whites, the moving into the political system? Has that been something that's been difficult to reconcile, or has it come natural for you?
I can primarily speak for myself, and it has come very natural for me. There have been statements of changes, and when the statement was initially made, I might have had to go home and study over it. But in studying over it, in a very short period of time, it would come to me very clearly, this is a natural evolution. And this is, as the chief minister has said, it's natural growth. And we're on the path of natural growth. So your acceptance of the change is really an indication of how willing and ready you are to accept what is right, what is just, and what is truth, rather than an indication that there is something wrong with the rate of change.
In an interview with the chief minister about 6 months ago, he conceded to me that there were some blacks in the Nation of Islam who were opposed to the admittance of Caucasians into the nation. Is that true? I mean, is it widespread? Are some people really opposed to it, or what?
Well, as you say, the chief minister did say that. If the chief minister said that to you 6 months ago, I'm sure he was speaking with awareness. He always does. And I have not been in a position to make any final or conclusive statements as to what extent it is or isn't. I myself have found it a natural change. So perhaps those who don't would not discuss that with me. But I have found it a very natural change, and I haven't really heard a lot of rumblings. But as Sister Dorothy said, all change brings with it difficulties. This is a natural part of growth, of anything that grows naturally, as an individual or a nation.
What about the movement into the political system? This seems to be a radical departure also. Is this a change that has come easy for members of the nation?
I would say so.
Just a minute, I blew that one, I'm sorry.
Has the adjustment to the political system and your participation in it, has that been a difficult adjustment, or is it something that members of the Nation of Islam are readily doing now?
I would say so, and of course I speak for myself. When people recognize its head, it follows the wisdom of that head. As an arm or a hand would not question the head in executing that order that has been sent down to that member of the body by its head, we as the followers of the chief minister recognize that he is knowledgeable, that he has the awareness that is necessary for us, that he is our leader. And when you follow the leader, you submit yourself to the truth that you know is in that leader.
What do you hope to gain, though, by participating in the political system? Is there something there that Muslims as a whole see that can be beneficial to black people as a whole?
A oneness. I hope to gain the oneness with the whole world that is necessary, the oneness of mind to go ahead and do what is necessary to improve the conditions of the world.
Well, I was just sitting here thinking of how much in unity Sister Fahima and I were, because I was thinking along the same lines and thinking that once you have accepted a leader, then you follow the leader, not that you follow him blindly, you know, because you're going to think and turn over in your mind, you know, am I in tune with this, or can I see that this is something that is in accord with the way I think. But having looked ahead and accepted Islam as a way of life, and having seen that it is founded on the highest principles, highest moral principles, the highest spiritual principles, then I keep this in mind at all times, that this is the goal that I'm striving for, and this is my leader and teacher. So I follow him. I accept it. And I can see that this will get us out into the community.
What about the year of change that has preceded this interview? Has it been something that has come easy, or has it been difficult for you?
Well, I would say that it has been, as the other brothers and sisters have said before me, it has been a natural change. Certainly having survived the greatest change and having conquered the greatest change or problem that I think I could have ever experienced, having been a Muslim for 13 years now, was the physical passing away of the Honorable Master Elijah Muhammad. And having sat last Savior's Day, as you said you sat, and having seen us survive this and having gained strength from this, once the Honorable Wallace D. Muhammad came before us as our leader and teacher, there was just a reassurance in me that everything is going to be all right, you know, and I have never wavered from that during this year. I saw in this man such a giant of a vision, and that he knows where he's going and he's not deviating from what the Honorable Master had taught us. You see, a leader sees farther than the followers. I think this is important, not to just look at the immediate things that are happening, you see, but you have to know that the leader is looking ahead. So I trust in his looking ahead, because from past experience, there have been other changes in the nation. You know, in studying the history of the Honorable Master Elijah Muhammad, there were many changes that came during his time. And I'm sure at that point, maybe after the first year of his teaching, people were saying the same thing.
Do any of you have an idea of where the nation is headed in your own mind? Do you see ultimately the Nation of Islam becoming a dominant social and political force in the black community?
Excuse me. I could not speak to ultimate, and that's why we have a leader, because he can see farther than us, and certainly he would be better able to see the ultimate than we would. But I do see, in retrospect, that many moves he has made are leading us to really accept the position that the Honorable Master Elijah Muhammad had already told us was our position, and that is that we were to be leaders. So it would only be natural to see the day come when we would be actually in training, or really, I should say, interning for that leadership role. And to speak to politics, the Honorable Master Elijah Muhammad didn't say there was something wrong with politics per se. He spoke to the corruption in politics. He didn't speak to the a natural corruption in the electoral process. He spoke to the corruption that prevailed in the politics of this country, and spoke to the corruption in politics around the world. So it wasn't politics that he said there was something wrong with. It was the corruption that he spoke to.
Sister Dorothy, I'd like to go back to a question that I asked you earlier. You mentioned to me an incident earlier in our conversation that concerned initial reaction of a black man to you being a Muslim. Would you relay that to us again?
Well, as I recall, we were talking about do people accept this or not? And I think I was trying to say people within the mosque and people in the street have many thoughts, because the teachings of the of Islam, the teachings of Honorable Elijah Muhammad, were known in the street. And this happened to be a brother, a black brother, who was not in the temple to my knowledge. He had visited the temple because this later came out. And he just, he questioned me. I was waiting for a bus. And
Slating, this is row 3, continuation of interview with Muslim followers. Sister Dorothy, you were relaying that anecdote about your encounter with that black man. Specifically, what happened?
Well, he just questioned me. We were waiting, but he had a certain respect. And he said, you know, I have many friends, and they talk about if they ever see a white Muslim, they're going to kill him. And we got on the bus, and he kept shaking his head. He said, you know, we happened to be sitting close by. He said, I don't like white people. He said, I never got along with them. I said, well, I don't get along with them either, brother. They're not the right kind of people. And he said, when he got off, he said, I'll tell you the truth. He said, I get up every morning thinking how I'm going to get out on whitey. But he said, I have to give respect, because any white person that goes to that temple has to be all right. And he got off. You know, there are varying degrees of people think out there in the street. They really think. They're weighing. They're getting, you know, they're weighing what's going on.
When you reflect back on what's happened to you, I mean, at one point, you could not come into the Temple of Islam. At one point, you could not become a member.
Mm-hmm.
But overnight,
mm-hmm.
you are now a part of this.
Mm-hmm.
You obviously enjoy it.
Mm-hmm.
Is there some feeling of gratification, some kind of satisfaction you get from being a Muslim?
Oh, certainly. With a people in a mission that I feel I can do something. Now, before I could come into the nation, I had, of course, for about 5 or 6 years, been in tune with the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and I felt what he was saying was the truth. And I felt that black people in America, as he taught, would, in a righteous way, if they could get themselves in a righteous state, would be able to lead others. And so, when you're out there in the world and you're not surrounded often by people who think like you do, then it is a little difficult because you're constantly fighting. Other than being with my husband, most of the time when I go out, the people I worked with and was surrounded with all day were not really in tune with me as far as being Muslims. So certainly I'm quite grateful. I had read very closely what the Master Elijah Muhammad wrote, and there were indications towards the end of his life when it appeared in the paper, he said, respect all people. And he even made indications towards Caucasians. I was watching for those things, and I kept saying, that's it, something's going to happen. I didn't know, I couldn't see, but I just knew there's something going to happen. When it happens, it's sort of a natural, well, that's it. And many times this question is asked of me, and I have a feeling people want me to say, oh, I got shaky, I started perspiring all over, you know, it was so emotional. But because it seemed like such a natural thing to me, it was just a natural feeling to go in and finally sit down and rest and say, well, I'm here amongst the people I want to be amongst.
What about you, Brother Abdullah? What kind of feeling did you get when you entered into the Nation of Islam?
Well, I was invited by a brother minister, Aziz, for the first time, and I didn't know that they accepted also Latin Americans. But when I first came in, I sat down on the first row, and I saw the check-in procedures, and the first thing that I noticed about the Nation of Islam was their organization. The check-in procedure, the security, the organization, and that really impressed me very favorably because I know that our communities need organization. Then I sat down on the first row, the knowledge of self and the morality aspect of the religion really made me feel, you know, that I really needed this and that I could really relate it to my people and that they could not feel alienated because of the nation.
Well, one day you were not allowed in. Then overnight, as a Latin, you're permitted to become a part of something you obviously wanted very badly. Again, was there a feeling of satisfaction, gratification? Are you at peace with yourself because you are a Muslim?
Yes, sir, very much so. Because in the Nation of Islam, really, once you come into the nation, really people don't, you know, see you as a Latin American, they see you as a brother, you know. And it is something that, you know, in Islam, what you learn is to submit to the laws of Allah. And there are so many Muslims all over the world. You know, I meet sometimes with Pakistani people and I say, Assalamu alaikum. And they say, Wa alaikum salam, where are you from? I say, I'm from Dominican Republic. And they say, well, do they have any Muslims there? I say, well, not too many. I'm really one of the first ones. But I see that there is a unity not only among the black people, but among the Chinese. I meet some Turkish Muslims, Lebanese Muslims. And I feel that they are my brothers, you see. So it feels pretty good.
What about the initial change? Was there any internal feeling once you accomplished this? Some kind of reward internally for you?
Yes, sir. The reward that I got internally was that for the first time I was able to feel
proud of myself as a non-white person. For the first time, I saw that in this racist society, I was able to see that I was also a human being due to the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. That I saw also a moral value in the teachings, that as a non-white person, I didn't have to follow the decadent morality of the whites. That I also, that my people, when they came from Africa into the Caribbean, they were not that way. And as I went into the history, they were Muslims. As a matter of fact, the first uprising of slaves in America was in my country, and they were Muslims that were that took part in that. So I went into the history of my people in Latin America, and it gave me the identity as a non-white person that I needed.
Brother Clyde, there were many whites who perceived the Nation of Islam as a physical, violent threat to white society. And there was nothing in Muslim history to play that down at all up until recently. First of all, was that perception accurate of the Nation of Islam? And secondly, why is that image being played down now?
First of all, I think the key is in the word perception. Whites perceived the Nation of Islam as being a violent threat because it was such a radical change from the completely submissive and docile disposition they had put our people into. And as a matter of fact, we were always the recipients of violence. So when it was turned around to say simply defend yourself, it seemed to them like this was a move to violent activity. But there was, as a matter of fact, there was nothing in the history of the Nation of Islam to play that up. The Nation of Islam had a reputation for being orderly and peaceful. And the FOI, the brothers class in the Nation of Islam, had always been noted for how orderly and peaceful they handled situations by everyone from citizens on the street to the police department. So as a matter of fact, there should have been much to indicate that it was not a violent threat. So I think this is a reflection of the racist mind that prevails rather than a reflection of the activities of the Nation of Islam.
Are you saying that at this point there is no effort to create a nonviolent image of the Nation of Islam, and that in fact a nonviolent image has always existed?
Islam means peace. And the Holy Quran, as well as the teachings directly from the Honorable Master Elijah Muhammad, and certainly this is consistent with the teachings of the Honorable Wallace D. Muhammad, tells you not to ever be the aggressor, but to defend yourself if attacked. And this was a move from a former state of being defenseless, a defenseless community, a totally defenseless community who accepted aggression from others peaceably, to a community that would be, willing to defend itself. So it is a change that I think the white audience may be responding to, and many Bilalians picked up this also. Black people picked this up also. It's a change. It's really not a move to nonviolence. It's really simply a statement of the fact the Nation of Islam has never been aggressive, imperialist, etc.
Did you still want to spend the time?
No.
Any man who stands up and give the people truth, he will get the majority on his side. I have the majority in the body, and I have the majority in the leadership. Minister Farrakhan, the champion, the greatest champ of all time as far as I'm concerned, Muhammad Ali, these people are my best supporters. My brother, Herbert Muhammad, he's one of my strongest supporters.
All right, listen. Huh? Get it on.
Now Wallace Muhammad has taken his boldest step yet, dropping the longtime membership ban on whites and other races. It is a move not welcomed by all.
Thank you.
In the 43 years since its inception, the black Muslim movement in the United States has undergone radical and sometimes violent changes, and it's had its share of internal dissension, as witnessed by the breakaway Hanafi faction. Randy Daniels has a report.
The roots of Islam are deep in the American black community. The movement began in the 1930s when Elijah Muhammad, known then as Elijah Poole, left the dusty auto assembly line to spread the meaning of Islam. He sought to lead what he called a lost people. He called himself the Messenger of Allah and wanted to bring them under the crescent that symbolizes the Muslim faith. But unity was something Elijah's Nation of Islam found difficult to achieve. Malcolm X, the fiery Muslim minister who gained prominence in the 1960s, was assassinated by Muslim gunmen in New York after breaking with Elijah. Malcolm X had fundamental differences with Elijah over the interpretation of Islamic scripture, often attacking him in public as a man obsessed with wealth and power. The story of the Hanafi Muslims is much the same. Hamas Khalis, the Hanafi leader who is spearheading the Washington takeover, was once a strong backer of Elijah Muhammad. In the early 1960s, he also broke away, calling Elijah a false prophet. In 1972, Khalis wrote a letter attacking Elijah and the Nation of Islam. He sent copies to members of the black Muslims. In 1973, a band of Philadelphia Muslims stormed this Washington house where the Hanafi sect is headquartered. They fatally shot two adults and one child. They drowned four other children. The Nation of Islam denies taking any part in the murders, but the Hanafi Muslims, who number about 1,000, believe the Nation of Islam was involved and want revenge.
We're dealing with brutal murders. A baby 9 days old. Most people are afraid to hold a baby that young. But here you got somebody that took that baby in their arms and drowned it. Khalifa Hamas Abdul Khalis lost his 9-day-old to 22 months and his daughters, you know, 6 times shot in the head. These is fiends, man. So it ain't so much about getting individuals. We talking about getting the essence of that product that would do that.
Wallace Muhammad, who succeeded his father as leader of the black Muslims, said that he has no knowledge of the murders other than press reports. The Hanafis believe in a very literal interpretation of the Muslim holy book, the Quran. They have had a running feud with the larger, better-known black Muslims for this reason. They say the building seizures in Washington are to secure peace, but so far they have managed only violence. Randy Daniels, CBS News, Chicago.
That house in Washington that the Hanafi sect uses as its headquarters was given them by pro basketball player Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. The other sports figure involved in this drama, boxing champion Muhammad Ali, was in Los Angeles today. He said he did not want to...
Terrorism television. Each new episode of kidnapping or hijacking seems to reinforce that link, raising questions about the role of the media in these nerve-wracking incidents. After last week's siege of Washington by a group of Hanafi Muslims holding well over 100 hostages, no less a source than the UN ambassador, Andrew Young, called it an example of glorifying and advertising these kinds of events. Newsmen call it covering the story. But when violent people are playing to the camera, there's no question that the medium itself can become a kind of hostage, and the reporter has to dodge and struggle to keep from being captured and used. That was the spot a Washington newsman named Max Robinson found himself in last week. As anchorman at television station WTOP, he was in the middle of that story that held the country's attention.
It was an act of terrorism so broad, so bizarre, so many lives at stake, that it brought the nation's capital to a standstill. After the murder of one man and the wounding of many others, the terrorists held three buildings and 134 hostages at gunpoint. Police vainly tried to set up some channel of communication with them. But this is an age of media consciousness, of politics by public terror, and the terrorists insisted on an audience for their negotiations. The only channel they would accept was the media. The man they wanted to communicate through was Max Robinson. For the last 2 years, the face and voice of WTOP's 6 and 11 p.m. newscasts, the broadcasts with the biggest local audience. The terrorists established a telephone dialogue with Robinson, who was the first to broadcast their demands. Among other things, that a new movie about the Prophet Muhammad be banned because they found it offensive.
But once the film is removed from this country, once you are asking that those responsible for the deaths or who killed your children be brought to the B'nai B'rith building.
And the ones that killed Malcolm.
And the ones that killed Malcolm.
That's right. I want them.
And you're asking for the $750.
I want them. And the $750. And be sure you make on the radio that I've turned down millions of dollars, so it's not the $750, but this dog-ass Judge Braben, he hold me in contempt of court. Because I charged the murderers that murder my babies. Now, what do you think about that? And you think I'm going to roll over and play dead? What do you think I am? Some kind of jokester? I take my face serious.
At 37, Robinson is a 12-year veteran of the news business. A college dropout, an Air Force man who went home to Virginia and started pounding on newsroom doors, unsuccessfully, until things started opening up for blacks in Washington. As a TV reporter around town, he had covered some big local stories, some other Muslim stories. His professional judgment, he says, had never been so critically tested.
When I had one, had to sell that. You think I went through all that as a joke, Max? Do you?
I understand what
you're
saying.
All right, then.
After
I'm very
the,
serious
you
about
have made
face.
Those, you have made
what
the...
about those sharpshooters, brother? They may have moved them somewhere else. Keep stacking, boys. Keep stacking, boys. Move it faster. Make them move faster, Latif. Work them.
Hamas?
Yes.
You talked to Police Chief Cullinane a few moments ago.
Yes.
What were your demands of him?
Same thing, Max. I'm through. All right? Been talking all day. Okay?
Thank you, sir.
All right.
In terms of understanding what you're covering, in terms of the sensitivity of what you're covering, you're talking about emotional sensitivity. It's a little different from sensitivity for facts. You can get the facts. All of us get the facts. That's a very important part of the business. In my struggle to be a good journalist, I have no fear of having that kind of sensitivity. But I recognize that the danger is that you can go overboard and become a participant, become an advocate. I think the only reason that I have been called a participant or that I was involved or in the middle, as has been said, and many expressions have been used, was simply because I got it first and I got an understanding of it. That's all.
If we have to air 15, ready, voiceover, and over.
By his direct contact on the air with the kidnappers, Robinson was already walking a thin line between reporter and messenger, between observer and participant. Now, a telephone call he was about to receive could push him over the line and into the story he was covering.
Ready? Hello?
Open Sunny's.
Hello.
Hi.
This is Max Robinson.
Mark, please.
Yes? What did I say? What did I say?
Tell her to call her on 61.
I said that.
We will.
I said that on the air.
Call us on 6136 as she talks to us.
You got a lot of time in sports.
Just let Max do this. Let Gordon do the rest.
What did I say about Malcolm?
Hi.
Would you tell me what I said? I can't. How can I straighten it up if you don't tell me what it was? They're going to kidnap me.
What?
I'm going to be kidnapped by the anonymous.
Let me have Gordon on the phone.
Let's get back to work.
With a wife and four children at home, Robinson didn't take the threat lightly. But it didn't change his approach to the story. He went back to his anchor position without visibly missing a beat.
Gordon Barnes, we've had pretty good weather for the past week or the past 4 or 5 days. Mm-hmm. Today wasn't
As good as I expected. We had some high clouds this afternoon.
Which is beginning of the weekend.
Although the audience remained unaware of the threat, news director Jim Snyder and his staff were concerned. They felt this was not just another crank call.
Thank you.
The guy sounds like he might be one of those folks. Yeah. They've taken three buildings. It would not be too difficult for them to take me, I would assume. You know, if you take three buildings, you can sure take a little reporter. And they say they're going to take me, meaning kidnap. Now, what have we done in terms of dealing with making that a little more difficult than it is right now? I'm telling you that he sounds like some of the Hanafis that I've run across.
We have security here in the building. You can stay here in the building.
You mean our regular security? Holy hell, that's awesome.
We're going to cop here in the middle of the afternoon.
We do have about three uniformed policemen downstairs.
Have you informed the police?
And indeed, two district policemen were brought in for Robinson's round-the-clock protection until the announcement that the hostages were finally released.
The ordeal of the entire city has ended. The ordeal of the hostages, the ordeal of those people who worked long hours. In fact, all of the people, the officials, who were involved for the past 39 hours in dealing with a situation the likes of which the nation's capital has never seen before. This story's not over, but certainly the dramatic part, the part that held this town on edge for 39, 40 some hours, that part is over. You can feel the relief, you can feel a sigh. In the nation's capital this morning, all of us feel. I think journalists are the last to feel it.
Last week in Washington, it was Max Robinson. Next week, it could be, as Walter Cronkite talked about in an interview, some other reporter, anywhere.
Since the terrorists seem to be getting better at handling us, are we getting any better at handling them?
Well, I don't know that we are. I suppose experience always counts for something, so maybe we are getting better. I don't know really, though, what we could or should do about this, Dan. It seems to me that we cannot control the events that need to be reported. All we can do is be responsible in reporting the events that occur.
Do you think it's fair criticism to say that we provoke the terrorists?
I think that it's something that is within the range of possibility. I don't think it can be dismissed quickly, but I don't see where that really counts on how we handle the story. I don't think we can suppress stories like this.
What about Ambassador Andrew Young Sunday said he wished, quote, there could be a law that would restrict the publication of information regarding violent crime. Now, could the First Amendment stand such a law?
No, couldn't at all, in no way. The First Amendment says there shall be no law which infringes on the freedom of speech and press.
In your judgment, what can we say to those people who continually say to us, listen, we cannot allow this to happen and keep happening and escalate each time, that those of you in the media have to do something?
I don't know how this society got so media-oriented in blaming the messenger for everything that transpires in our society and for all of its ills. We are only the messenger. It's other aspects of society which have to take action. Speedier justice, better forms of justice, perhaps. Better way to treat those who have just or unjust claims against society. We have to report it.
With television's instantaneous coverage and the resulting instantaneous decisions of what we cover, what is aired, how we air it, do we have enough time in television to contemplate the consequences of what we do?
I'm not sure we should be concerned about the consequences of what we do, though. Those are strong words, I know, and they're inclined to come back to haunt one because I've said them before, and I know what the dangers of it, of that statement can be.
You know, a lot of people are going to say, well, Mr. Cronkite, you've got to worry about the consequences.
That's right, but you see, when we start worrying about the consequences, we're beginning to play another role other than that of reporters. We're beginning to play a judgmental role. We're beginning to play God. And I don't think I'm equipped to do that. I'm not sure I know any journalist who is.
A woman from the PTA or a businessman down the street says to you, Mr. Cronkite, why wouldn't you be in favor of a complete and total blackout once something like this happens? What's your answer?
Because that's not serving the public's best interests at all. All that does is lead to rumor and speculation, to doubts that the press is telling the whole story under any circumstances. And that's the most important consideration of all. If we cover up stories under any circumstance, the public has every right to believe that we cover them up under any circumstance. And if we cover up at all, then the whole belief, reliance upon the press is gone.
Last question. This whole subject scares the hell out of me, does it? You?
Yes, it does. Sure. I think it's a very, very serious problem for all of us. And we needn't go into here the permutations of it. But I think that's why you're scared. That's why I'm scared. We all know that they're there.
In prison at this moment are three men serving life terms for murder, but two of those men may be innocent. The man who acknowledges he committed the crime says the other two had nothing to do with it. The man who was murdered was one of the most charismatic figures of the civil rights movement of the 60s, shot down in New York City back in 1965. Who really killed him? Who killed Malcolm X? We set out to find some answers to that question last January when we first broadcast this report. There were rumors at the time that Malcolm was a target of the white establishment, perhaps of the FBI, perhaps even the CIA. But the truth, it seems, was less sinister. Before long, it became apparent to those looking into his death that he had been gunned down by the black Muslims. Why the black Muslims? Malcolm had had a falling out with the leader of the black Muslims, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, a man deeply revered by his disciples. Malcolm had committed the unforgivable sin of charging that his former leader, Elijah Muhammad, was an adulterer, that he had fathered children with several of his female assistants.
I talked with Malcolm about that back in 1964.
And how many of these illegitimate children did he father with the sisters?
Well, he made six sisters pregnant. They all had children. Two of those six had two children. One of those two is having a child right now.
Malcolm was aware, even as he spoke, that what he was saying would cause him to be called a traitor by the black Muslims.
If someone came to me and I had no knowledge whatsoever of what had taken place and they told me what I'm saying, I would kill them myself.
Are you not perhaps afraid of what might happen to you as a result of making these revelations?
Oh, yes. I probably am a dead man already.
6 months later, he was. And this is one of the men who killed him, Thomas Hagen, a New Jersey black Muslim sentenced to life in prison for murdering Malcolm X. Hagen admits to the murder and says he killed him because of what Malcolm was saying about his religious leader, Elijah Muhammad. But in addition to Hagen, two other black Muslims were arrested and charged with the killing. This is Norman Butler, a devout Muslim who has earned a college degree in prison. So far, he has spent 17 years of a life term in prison for killing Malcolm X.
Norman Butler, did you kill or help to kill Malcolm X?
Absolutely not.
Where were you on the day Malcolm was killed?
At home. I was at home.
And this is Thomas Johnson, also a practicing Muslim, also serving a life term for killing Malcolm X.
Did you play any part in the killing of Malcolm X?
None whatsoever.
You swear it?
I swear it, none whatsoever. If I was there, you was there, Harry Reasoner was there, and we all perpetrated this together. Mm. That's the cold facts.
But despite what Johnson and Butler say, the books remain closed in their case. And the question of their guilt or innocence would not even be raised now were it not for the sworn testimony of Thomas Hagen, the only one of the three who has admitted from the beginning that he took part in the killing. This is what he has to say about Butler and Johnson, the two men convicted with him.
These men are innocent. They're innocent. I cannot say why witnesses testified against them, but I can honestly say that it's not the first time that witnesses have lied against men. What has happened to these men is just as bad as what has happened to Malcolm.
The three have been serving time in three different prisons in the state of New York. Three convicted assassins, with the one maintaining that the other two are innocent. But before we take a closer look at their story, more about the man whose murder put these men behind bars.
We declare our right on this earth to be a man, to be a human being, to be respected as a human being, to be given the rights of a human being in this society, on this earth, in this day, which we intend to bring into existence by any means necessary.
This was Malcolm X, the fiery evangelist for the black Muslims, the Nation of Islam. A militant, a man many feared could lead the black Muslims in violent revolt.
We are peaceful people. We are loving people. We love everybody who loves us. But we don't love anybody who doesn't love us. We're nonviolent with people who are nonviolent with us. But we are not nonviolent with anyone who is violent with us.
Toward the end of his life, Malcolm talked a good deal less of violence, and he had left the black Muslims to form his own organization. But on February 21st, 1965, he came here to the Audubon Ballroom in Upper Manhattan to address a group of those still faithful to him, his allies.
Malcolm had just been introduced, and he came on stage here, greeting the audience with the traditional Muslim phrase, "Assalam alaikum." Suddenly, an argument broke out several rows back in the audience. Malcolm urged the crowd to calm down, and his bodyguards moved toward the disturbance out there. It was then the shots rang out. Malcolm fell to the floor. In the chaos that followed, more shots were fired into Malcolm's body.
The only man arrested at the scene of the crime was Thomas Hagen. He virtually fell into the hands of police, who had to tear him from Malcolm's angry followers. Norman Butler and Thomas Johnson were not picked up as suspects until a week after the killing. Both were well-known Manhattan Muslims, both well-known enemies of Malcolm. As for Thomas Hagen,
you swear on Allah, by Allah, that you killed Malcolm X and that you were not helped by Norman Butler and Thomas Johnson. I swear on it. I swear on it 1,000 times. I swear on it 1,000,000 times. I swear on it 1,000,000 times. They had nothing to do with this. They had nothing to do with this. Nothing at all.
You have nothing to gain, really, from telling the truth now. Why are you talking about this?
Oh, I have something to gain.
What's that?
My self-dignity. My self-dignity. This is what I have to gain.
How do you mean, your self-dignity?
I got involved in this because of my beliefs, not because I'm a hired killer. I realize that I have made this mistake in my life, but I can't change what happened. But I can speak on what has happened to these two individuals.
Well, if Hagen is right and Butler and Johnson are innocent, then who did help Hagen to kill Malcolm? Thomas Hagen has now submitted to New York authorities the names of four men who he says helped him kill Malcolm X. We have obtained their names. They were all members of the Newark, New Jersey mosque to which Hagen belonged back in 1965. At least two of those men still live in the New Jersey area. Hagen says he did not reveal those names previously simply to keep the Nation of Islam out of the case. But a New York Supreme Court judge has ruled that Hagen's story does not constitute new evidence. He says that the word of a confessed killer years after the fact is not enough to reopen the case. I spoke with Thomas Johnson at Dannemora Prison and reminded him he had expressed openly his hatred of Malcolm.
Did you ever think about killing Malcolm X, honest?
Yes. I would say this. I felt that he was worthy of it. I felt he was worthy of death for what he was doing. I don't know if I could actually carry it out. I've never murdered anybody.
The other man, Norman Butler, at Sing Sing Prison, says that he and Johnson were so well known that they would never have been allowed into the Audubon Ballroom by Malcolm's bodyguards. But I pointed out there were several eyewitnesses who testified in court that he and Thomas Johnson were involved in the shooting.
But I'm saying the eyewitnesses lied. And all of the people that spoke against me at the trial, among all of them, none of them knew me. Why didn't one of the people that knew me come to testify at the trial? If the people that were in that ballroom that knew me were convinced that I did it, the underground talk in the street would have said so-and-so-and-so did it because they know me. But the underground talk in the city didn't say that because I wasn't there.
This man knew Butler and Johnson well. He is Benjamin Goodman, and he was Malcolm's chief assistant who introduced Malcolm X to the audience just moments before he was shot. And he agrees that Butler and Johnson could not have positioned themselves up front in the auditorium without Malcolm's security people noticing them. I talked with him at the Audubon Ballroom on the spot where Malcolm was shot.
All right, we had men on the door to watch for people who came in from number seven.
Number seven. That was the New York Black Muslim temple in which Johnson and Butler were members.
Anyone who came in from number seven was supposed to have been stopped, and Malcolm or myself or James told that they were here. They could come in as long as we were informed that they were here from number seven.
How well did you know Norman Butler and Thomas Johnson then?
Very well.
By sight?
Yes.
To talk to?
Yes.
You're up here talking to the audience.
Yes.
Were they in the front row or the third row or the fourth row?
No, absolutely not.
They were not there?
No.
You are certain of that?
Yes. Yes. You said they were sitting here? Second, third, or fourth row?
Yes.
They weren't there.
Were they any place in this room that you knew?
No.
You would have recognized them?
Of course.
Well, these are the men who are in jail and have been in jail for killing Malcolm X for the last 17 years.
But they're innocent. They weren't here. They weren't sitting out here.
Well, wait. You were Malcolm's friend.
His assistant.
You knew these men?
Yes. They were not sitting out here. They are not the men that killed Malcolm.
Benjamin Goodman's story may be a case of too little, too late, for he did not volunteer to testify at the trial 17 years ago. He says the bitterness between Malcolm's followers and Butler and Johnson scared him off. But neither was he called to testify by the defense lawyers. William Chance was Norman Butler's court-appointed lawyer, and he was convinced his client was innocent. I asked him if he had sought out Benjamin Goodman as a defense witness.
Benjamin Goodman, you know who he is?
No, I don't.
Benjamin Goodman was an assistant minister to Malcolm, and he's the fellow who introduced Malcolm that day. And he now swears that Norman Butler and Thomas Johnson, but Norman Butler, your client, was not in the Audubon Ballroom that day. Did you ever try to talk to Benjamin Goodman?
I do not recall whether I ever talked to Benjamin Goodman or not.
What effort then, Mr. Chance, did you make to get this man off?
Well, I investigated his case, I interviewed him, and I cross-examined the witnesses at the trial.
It turns out that another important eyewitness was overlooked by the defense. Gene Roberts, an undercover police officer posing as a member of Malcolm's inner circle. He is pictured here giving Malcolm mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. He declined to talk to us on camera, and he wouldn't tell us whether he believes Butler and Johnson are guilty or innocent. But when we asked him why he hadn't testified at their trial, he simply said he hadn't been called to testify.
Did you try to talk to Gene Roberts on the stand?
I do not recall whether I ever talked to Gene Roberts or not, or who Gene Roberts is. I do not know who Gene Roberts is.
Isn't all of this material to an understanding? If you are defending a man on trial for his life...
That's correct.
And there's an undercover cop there in the room, wouldn't you want to talk to him? Wouldn't you want to talk to Benjamin Goodman, who had faced the audience?
If I knew, or if I had heard that was an undercover, had any information leading to the fact that he was there.
But still you believe that you gave him an adequate defense?
I know that I did. I know that I did.
You just couldn't persuade the jury.
Well, I didn't persuade the jury. Let's put it that way.
And Thomas Hagen also failed to persuade the jury. In spite of his testimony halfway through the trial in 1966, that Butler and Johnson were innocent. I asked him why he didn't speak the truth about Butler and Johnson and name his true accomplices earlier.
I think that we all felt that there would be no chances of any conviction for them at all in regards to this.
Why?
Of their innocence. I knew that they was not involved. They knew that they was not involved. And I think that they felt they had a tight defense. Really, you know, I felt that way right on up until, you know, at one point in the trial, it became obvious that, hey, you know, this thing is going in another direction.
You're saying that the witnesses who testified in court lied.
They definitely lied. Definitely lied.
But what about those eyewitnesses, the ones who convinced a jury 17 years ago that Johnson and Butler had taken part in the killing? Two witnesses are dead. Two others, both with criminal records, we've not been able to locate. But we were able to find one witness. In a courtroom that he asked be cleared of all spectators, this witness had sworn that Norman Butler was one of the men he saw running from the Audubon Ballroom here after the shooting. But that is not what he says today. The witness, who prefers not to be identified, declined to meet with us on camera. He said that he's afraid to get involved. But he does admit he did not actually see Norman Butler here at the scene of the assassination. And he now alleges the police lineup at which he identified Butler was contrived, a phony, a setup by members of the New York City Police Department. What about Thomas Johnson? This witness now says he knew Johnson well, and he's convinced Thomas Johnson was not here in the ballroom when Malcolm was killed. And finally, there is this. Thomas Hagen has always maintained that his true accomplices were from the Newark, New Jersey Muslim mosque. But Norman Butler and Thomas Johnson were from Manhattan. We were able to locate several hundred pages of FBI surveillance material on Malcolm X with information about his murder. And among those documents was a communication which claimed that one of the Bureau's informants had indeed recognized two of the gunmen as being members of the Newark Temple. And there is this from the American Muslim Mission, the present-day black Muslims. In a letter to us, Wallace Muhammad, their current leader, son of Elijah Muhammad, the man whom Malcolm had publicly accused as an adulterer, told us he has reason to believe that neither Norman Butler nor Thomas Johnson were the men who killed Malcolm X. But he declined to elaborate for us, either in his letter or on camera.
We received another letter from Manhattan DA Robert Morgenthau, who says the courts have given Butler and Johnson every chance to prove their innocence. And he says Benjamin Goodman, the man who introduced Malcolm moments before he was shot, did not tell the same story in 1965 that he is telling us now. However, D.A. Morgenthau declined to appear on camera to talk further about the case.
After all of this, one who spends time looking at the killing of Malcolm X is left with some puzzling questions. For instance, why was Benjamin Goodman, the man who introduced Malcolm X here, moments before he was shot, a man who knew both Johnson and Butler well, why was he never called to testify at their trial? Why was the defense never told there was a New York City undercover police officer present when the fatal shots were fired? And why was that police officer, an eyewitness, never called by prosecution lawyers who did know that he was in the ballroom? Finally, why the reluctance on behalf of authorities to follow up on Thomas Hagen's story? Why their reluctance to learn more about the four men he has named as his true accomplices in the murder of Malcolm X? Since we broadcast that report, attorneys have submitted applications for clemency on behalf of Norman Butler and Thomas Johnson, but there has been no response from New York's Governor Hugh Carey.
Jewish groups and black Muslims are angry at Los Angeles Mayor Tom Bradley. The Jewish groups are angry because Bradley did not condemn in advance a speech made by black Muslim leader Louis Farrakhan on Saturday. Bradley later said his silence actually led Farrakhan to tone down his remarks, even though they contained strong undercurrents of anti-Semitism.
Hatred, violence, and bigotry, wherever it occurs, that includes Minister Farrakhan.
Later, Farrakhan said he gave no indication at all to Bradley on what he would say and that he wouldn't compromise the truth to pacify Jews or anyone else. He spoke at a news conference yesterday.
This shows a contempt for truth and a contempt for black people, and that he bowed to the pressure of the Jewish community.
And now Bradley finds himself between a rock and a hard place. He faces losing the support of Jewish voters who have backed him in the past and may not support him in his next bid for the
governor. In Iron America, a troubling fact of life here in the United States, tension between different racial, ethnic, and religious groups. Is there a new racism? Is there a new anti-Semitism? The focus tonight, blacks and Jews. Richard Threlkeld looks at how and why tension sometimes explodes into violence.
At the right time.
A sermon from Louis Farrakhan, the black preacher.
The old Jewish relationship with black people has to be changed.
What people call Greenberg and Weisberg.
A lecture about Hollywood from Dr. Leonard Jeffries, a college professor.
Russian Jewry had a particular control over the movies.
This from Bill Tatum, the editor of a black newspaper about Jews.
I want a partner. I want a friend. I don't want a boss.
Hard words, in public and more often in private, from many black Americans from all walks of life, that Jews, rich and powerful Jews, are using their wealth and power to keep blacks second-class citizens. It's an ugly refrain that Jews have heard before in other times and places, and it might have been dismissed as just talk until this summer in New York City's Crown Heights. Mobs of young black men enraged when a Jewish motorist accidentally killed a black child stormed through the streets yelling, "Kill the Jews," and in fact killed a Jewish passerby. It was terrifying, and the cause of it was black anti-Semitism, pure and simple, according to Abraham Foxman of the Anti-Defamation League.
Underlying it could be hundreds of reasons, none of them we believe to justify kill the Jews, Heil Hitler, or to murder a human being because he's Jewish.
Jews wonder why moderate black leaders didn't speak out more loudly against the violence.
I want the leadership in black community to understand my paranoia when it comes to silence, when people say, "Kill the Jews."
Hazel Dukes of the NAACP says the moderates did speak out, but the mostly white media paid attention only to the extremists.
There's widespread anti-Semitism. The black communities turned on the Jews.
Nonsense.
Nonsense. Far from the truth.
Would I take a gun and shoot you?
But there has been a history of tension in this part of the city. Blacks insist the Jews get all the best of it.
Special treatment in terms of police protection, housing, jobs.
You'd think blacks and Jews would be better neighbors. They fought together for civil rights in the South, and some Jews were killed in that fight. But young blacks on the streets of Crown Heights don't remember those days.
Ancient history. They care less about the struggle. Where am I today? Where are my parents who worked two jobs? Why can't we have decent housing?
That kind of hopelessness. You reach a kind of a dead end and you need somebody to act out against. Why us? Well, because of that free-floating anti-Semitism that exists in Japan, Poland, and in Brooklyn.
Letty Cotton Prograben has studied black-Jewish relations.
Go back to Israel!
She says Jews are afraid, not just of black rage, but of something more terrible, the Holocaust.
6 million never again! 6 million never again!
Fear is as palpable to us as economic disadvantages to them. It's very hard to understand. We seem to be speaking out of enormous privilege and high status and economic success. We are speaking out of tremulous fear.
Yes, we do understand it. We understand there are bodies in Mississippi crying now from the Delta. We can't even count the numbers from our own Holocaust. We've had it.
You only know what you want to know.
This tragic falling out between blacks and Jews is a reminder of just how vulnerable these two American minorities still are. The danger, said one of those we spoke with, is that we will destroy each other to the delight of those who wish to destroy us both. Richard Threlkeld, CBS News, New York.
The fiery words of black Muslim minister Louis Farrakhan have once again become the catalyst of friction between blacks and Jews. Last year, his description of Judaism as a gutter or dirty religion was a thorn in the side of Jesse Jackson's presidential campaign, which Farrakhan was supporting.
The disciple of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is here, Minister Louis Farrakhan Muhammad.
This past Saturday, Farrakhan spoke to a crowd of 15,000 in Los Angeles.
Jewish groups in the area expected an anti-Semitic message.
The best thing you can do is tell the people I'm a hater, I'm a bigot, I'm an anti-Semite. Now you all listen to me tonight for the next few minutes and you judge me for yourself.
Jewish leaders had asked Los Angeles Mayor Tom Bradley to renounce Farrakhan, then attacked Bradley for condemning the minister after the speech instead of before.
I repudiate racism, hatred, violence, and bigotry wherever it occurs. That includes Minister Farrakhan.
It has been a bitter battle in Los Angeles. Now, this whole affair out there prompts some important questions. What damage could have been caused here? Where do relations stand between blacks and Jews all across the nation? Let's see if we can find some answers from our guests this morning. First, in Los Angeles, Marshall Grossman. He is with that city's Jewish Federation Council. With him there in L.A., John Mack, president of the Los Angeles Urban League. Joining us in Boston is Dr. Alvin Poussant. He is with the Harvard Medical School. He is an advisor to the Reverend Jesse Jackson. He is a renowned expert on black America and in Washington. Syndicated columnist Ben Wattenberg of the American Enterprise Institute. Let's begin in Los Angeles, Mr. Grossman. I know it has been a tumultuous struggle out there in Los Angeles, but to much of the nation, this is a rather distant battle. Can you give us some perspective and help us understand why the struggle is so bitter now?
Yes, sir. This is a battle involving all Americans. Mr. Farrakhan is fueled with a $5 million interest-free loan from Libyan dictator Gaddafi. Gaddafi is the principal exporter of terrorism throughout the world. He sends his hitmen throughout Western Europe, and his hand-picked messenger here in the United States is Farrakhan. Farrakhan preaches a message of hate for all of us. He calls the United States government the most immoral government in the world. He preaches that blacks are better than whites. He, of course, attacks all Jews. He says Hitler was a great man, and he attacks distinguished black leaders who disagree with him. Just 2 months ago, he called for the assassination and beheading of black Mayor Wilson Good of Philadelphia and asked his followers to roll his head down the street.
Mr. Grossman, that's Farrakhan. Mr. Grossman, I understand that you don't like Mr. Farrakhan. What are you upset about what happened in Los Angeles?
In Los Angeles, Mr. Farrakhan came to our city and spread his message of hate, again attacking whites, attacking Jews, and attacking established black leaders.
And Mr. Mack, I gather that Mr. Grossman is also upset that Tom Bradley, the mayor of Los Angeles, did not renounce Louis Farrakhan before he spoke. Should Bradley have done that?
No, I think not. I think the mayor was absolutely correct. First of all, he decided that even though he has sharp differences of opinion with Minister Farrakhan does have a right to free speech. In addition, he felt that it would be premature to decide in advance what Minister Farrakhan was going to say, since he could not crawl inside of his head and know what he was going to say. In addition, the mayor and others of us felt that actually our Jewish colleagues who were so mightily and who are so mightily upset and uptight about Minister Farrakhan were playing into the minister's hands. After all, he has been known to black people for 30 years. He has his hardcore followers. And he does obviously have that tradition. But by the same token, black people are basically committed to the Judeo-Christian way of life. And up until this point, and really up until last year, black America knew about him, but white America discovered him last year as a result of the campaign. We felt that, frankly, all of this orchestrated crescendo, which went to a frantic pitch leading up to the minister's visit in Los Angeles, escalated and exacerbated the problem rather than resolve the problem.
All right, sir. Dr. Poussant, focus this for us a little bit. I think one thing we are hearing from the Jewish community is, all right, Minister Farrakhan is talking about economic issues surrounding blacks, but he is using some very powerful language, calling Hitler a great man, calling Judaism wicked hypocrisy. And they're saying to black leaders around the country, do you not understand why we would like you to renounce that part as strongly as you possibly can? What do you make of that?
Well, I think the Jewish community has some legitimate concerns. Farrakhan does say things about the Jewish community that are angry and hostile, and I think they should be concerned. I also think that they have a right to pressure black leaders, that they should do that. How the black leaders respond is another story. The question of when you should intervene is another one. For instance, I think there's some assumption on the part of some people that Farrakhan is going to change his views, and I don't think that is so. So I don't think it makes sense to wait until he speaks and then to say you repudiate him. I think that Farrakhan is very clear about how he feels on these issues. He says that he speaks the truth and he is a prophet. And there's some things that Farrakhan says that I have some agreement with. I don't have agreement with some of the undercurrents I feel, his singling out Jewish people or generalizing too much about Jewish people. Now, to some that may not be anti-Semitism, but it's clear that he has some angry feelings toward Jews that he stirs up and brings into his speeches much too frequently.
Mr. Wattenberg, what do you think that Mr. Farrakhan is doing with his speeches? Well, I think the issue is not so much Mr. Farrakhan, who I find his views obviously repugnant. The issue is who and how publicly is going to renounce him. We live in a country with many races, many religious, many ethnic groups. Unless responsible leaders of those groups are going to act responsibly and denounce the crazies that you find in any group, then they're not responsible leaders. And I think a number of people in the Jewish community feel that some people in the black community, by no means all of them, have been too slow and not public enough in denouncing the sorts of vile things that Minister Farrakhan has to say, and I think that's the issue. Mr. Mack, what we're seeing here is a man who has gotten an inordinate amount of publicity, and I wonder if that's because he is a very charismatic speaker, and largely that, or is it that he has touched on a rift that has been growing over the years between the black community and the Jewish community, and as he has left Los Angeles, he has left Los Angeles torn. Is it possible that there's a deeper controversy that we're looking at here?
Oh, I think no question about it, and actually in response to your question, I think it's a little of both. First of all, I think it should be pointed out that at no time did Mayor Bradley nor any of the others of us within the black community take the position that we agree fully and by hook, line, and sinker where Minister Farrakhan is coming from. The economic development, the self-help advocacy that he espouses among black people is that part of his message that we subscribe to. Anti-Semitism, we totally reject, and we always have. But regarding the rift, I do feel that we're at a point here, and a part of it is about the quality of relationships existing between blacks and Jews. In Los Angeles, there are a number of us who have worked very hard over the years, and we've felt that we have maintained good and effective relationships between blacks and Jews, with Mayor Bradley, frankly, leading the charge. Part of it is we had recognizing that there can be legitimate and honest differences of opinion between friends, if you will, within the black and Jewish community as to strategically how best to deal with situations such as the one that we just occurred. And frankly, we didn't feel that there was any willingness on the part of our Jewish allies to even acknowledge or allow for the possibility that maybe our strategy had some merit.
All right, so Dr. Poussin, can there be some healing between the two groups at this point? What ought they to do?
Well, I think a lot of healing has taken place already. I think for the past year, black and Jewish groups have been getting together all over the country and talking and having discussions and trying to work on many issues in many cities. They're doing that here in Boston and in New York. So I think a lot of the rift is being healed. There are some differences. I think the main difference that the black community had with many of the Jewish organizations was around affirmative action. Now, many of the Jewish organizations support affirmative action, but that is not the image that they have in the black community because they're against goals and quotas, which some people would agree with, but people feel that they have created an atmosphere in the United States that is hostile to affirmative action, you know, and therefore detrimental to the black community.
Dr. Poussin, it's quite interesting. There's some survey research, which I guess you're familiar with, is that 3/4 of blacks in the United States are opposed to quotas and special preference.
That's fine.
So the position that some, and you're right, it is only some Jewish organizations are taking is the same position that the black public, not the black leadership, would take, and that most Americans take, black, white, Jewish, or Gentile.
I agree, but because I think the Jewish leadership has been so much out front on this issue that they have created the feeling of hostility toward affirmative action, whether they wanted to or not. I think it was just a bad political move that they made, and that they are now suffering some of the consequences.
Affirmative action.
Let me jump in, if I may. We only have a little bit of time, and Mr. Grossman really hasn't had much opportunity to speak. Let me turn to you, Mr. Grossman, if I may. What we're seeing right there is a clear division between the two groups. Does that division remain in Los Angeles, or do you now begin a process of healing, as I had asked earlier? Are you going to be talking with one another?
Yes. In fact, Mr. Mack and I had dinner last night, and we're meeting with the mayor Monday morning, but I must respond to a point made by Mr. Mack. He said that many black leaders subscribe to the economic programs of Mr. Farrakhan, but reject his anti-Semitism. That is unacceptable to us. How would our black colleagues feel if the Grand Dragon of the Ku Klux Klan came to town, preaching economic hope for poor whites, but wrapping it up by blaming blacks for their plight? We would be expected to, and we would stand up and unreservedly and unconditionally condemn such a racist. We expect and we need the help of our colleagues across the community in rejecting such a racist, whether he be black or white.
Gentlemen, I'm afraid the time is running short. Therein lies a part of the problem. There are obviously some differences of opinion.
I think I see the problem, gentlemen, and I am sorry to tell you that I'm going to stop, and we will continue the conversation after we're off the air. I think we see the dissonance that exists.
And another example of racial tension in the wake of the Rodney King verdict and the violence in Los Angeles. This country's leading African-American movie director is having troubles with the mostly white Hollywood establishment. Giselle Fernandez has the story.
47 Apple, take three. Hey, Mark.
Controversial film director Spike Lee, known for his insightful depiction of black culture on screen, is charging Hollywood with racism. The studios, he says, limit their financial exposure by investing more in white films than black.
There's this perception on the part of Hollywood that the white moving-going masses are still reluctant to see a film that has black subject matter. So that's the case, and they're going to try to limit their exposure.
Lee made the charges when Warner Brothers stopped production on his upcoming epic, Malcolm X, when it went over budget. Lee accused the studios of investing more in movies like JFK than in those that feature a black hero. Hollywood insiders say this is not a black and white issue.
The issue is, you know, passionate filmmakers wanting as much time and money to tell their stories as they can get, and the studios wanting to ensure that they can make a profit on the film.
No studio executive would comment on the record for fear of being labeled racist, especially now in the aftermath of the LA riots. Spike Lee was in Hollywood during those violent days, screening a rough cut of his new film.
And everything that's come out of Denzel's mouth, as Malcolm X, is explaining why the city of Los Angeles is burning down at the same exact time outside the studio.
We didn't land on Plymouth Rock. Plymouth Rock landed on us.
When Warner Brothers turned its back, Lee, determined to save the project, turned for the first time to friends like Bill Cosby, Oprah Winfrey, and Michael Jordan. It was one of the toughest things he's ever done.
I mean, I've never asked Michael Jordan for anything in my life, and it was very hard for me to pick up the phone and say, Mike, you know, you gotta write that check. We're always often accused of not being unified, but this is definitely a case where some black folks, some money, you know, stood up.
Background action!
While some black artists have made great strides in film, there is not one single black executive in any position of real power at any of the major studios. Until that changes, Spike Lee says he and other black filmmakers may have to fight in the spirit of Malcolm X, using any means necessary.
Cut!
Giselle Fernandez, CBS News, New York.
Agree with him.
In New York last night, X marked the spotlight as the film crowd gathered for the premiere of one of this year's most talked about movies, Malcolm X. Linda Tyra reports.
It's probably not what Malcolm X would have expected. Limousines bearing celebrities, even a beret-hatted Madonna for the world premiere of the film bearing his name.
Everyone who came after Malcolm's death should know who he was and what he was all about.
But for all the stars who came out, the real center of attention was the man who rose and fell as a leader of the Nation of Islam and was slain in 1965.
I think that they're going to see the film. It's going to broaden their knowledge. And if they haven't read the book, they're going to want to pick up the book and read it.
I don't want to say the film is about this or about that, but I think it's a film people will enjoy and learn from. And they have to decide what it means to them.
This Hollywood account of a martyred political figure could prove to be this year's JFK, giving many young Americans their first, perhaps lasting, but not always historically accurate impression of the life and times of Malcolm X.
Last night in New York, the early reviews were in.
And it's very moving, a very, very, very touching film.
Well, I like how he got the message across. I read the book, and it was super.
The real Malcolm X was one of the most fiery messengers of the Nation of Islam, controversial in life. And now with this new movie, the Hollywood Malcolm X promises to reignite the controversy for a new generation. Linda Tyra, CBS News, New York.
It's 6 p.m. this morning.
It is 10 minutes before the hour. $2.4 million. That's great box office for a Wednesday, and that's what opening day crowds paid out to see Malcolm X yesterday. Yesterday, director Spike Lee told us how he raised the $40 million it took to make the movie. I also asked him if he was ever worried that the movie would not appeal to a broad audience.
I think you just try to do, and if it's good enough, people are going to come. But the minute black artists start thinking about crossover, they start diluting the work, watering it down, and the work suffers.
Some of Lee's toughest critics have been African Americans. Syndicated columnist Carl Rowan said of Spike Lee in his movie, he is irresponsible in asking kids to stay out of school and black people to risk precious jobs to go see it.
What's it like when black people criticize what you do?
I think that you have to have tough skin being a filmmaker. And as Public Enemy said, every brother ain't a brother. And, you know, Malcolm and Carl Rowan tangle on a couple of things anyway. And when Malcolm X talked about handkerchief head Uncle Tom Negroes, that's a good description of Carl Rowan.
That's what you think of Carl Rowan?
Exactly.
Telling young kids to stay out of school to come see your movie,
you know,
got a lot of people up in arms because they say,
you know,
in the African
a lot of people got up in arms about a misquote.
What was the quote?
The quote was that, I said this in Detroit, it'd be great if African Americans could rally around the film, people take the day off from work, and parents take their children out of school and go see the film as family to see this film. That is not Spike Lee saying, okay, young black kids all across America, drop out of school, play hooky, forget about your education, go see this film. Those are two separate statements.
Well, the way when people hear it, though,
I have no control of that. Did Spike Lee tell people, Spike Lee tell the media that I'm only speaking to black journalists? No, but that was what reported.
What, how did that whole thing come about? Because that was in the Times that you said you preferred black journalists.
I said I prefer. That is not saying Spike Lee's only going to speak to black journalists. Again, that's two separate things.
Talk, maybe not generated by you, talk about problems, friction between you and his family. What's the story on that?
I mean, Betty, Dr. Baisha Bass has very strong views, and I mean, it was Malcolm with the husband. But in the meantime, I'm directing this film. And
beautiful day in Birmingham.
He's home alone again. Ah, Macaulay Culkin tomorrow on CBS This Morning.
It is 10 minutes until the hour. The waiting is over. Malcolm X opens in theaters across the country today. Spike Lee's epic movie stars Oscar winner Denzel Washington as the outspoken minister. I talked to Denzel Washington about playing someone as controversial as Malcolm X.
Before there was any such thing as a Republican or a Democrat, we were black.
The responsibility of bringing Malcolm X to life on screen was a tremendous task for actor Denzel Washington, a role he says was important because of what Malcolm means to so many people.
I think it's a role that I have been preparing for my whole career, pretty much. I mean, I did a play about Malcolm X 11 years ago, and just about everything I've done between then and now has prepared me for this role.
When the Negro, the so-called Negro in America, gets on God's side and listens to the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, he'll want to get off of drugs.
People's image of him are the ones that they've been given. his love for his people is what made him tell the truth. You know, they called him a violent man. He wasn't a violent man. He said, if somebody's trying to put a rope around your neck and you do anything that you can to get that rope from around your neck, and then that person calls you violent, you know, the wolf calling the sheep the violent one, when the wolf is, you know, killing the sheep. And all he said was, you know, don't let the wolf kill you.
Malcolm X said a lot of things. If you had to focus on one thing as being maybe his most important message from this movie, what would it be?
Well, he said so many things. What jumps right out to me is he said, you know, if you've been taught that you haven't done anything, then you can never do anything. You have to study your history. You have to see what was done to you to understand where you can go and how to go about it.
You're not an American. You're an African who happens to be an American.
The movie chronicles the life of Malcolm Little, street hustler, and his metamorphosis to Malcolm X, the spiritual leader, and martyr after his assassination in 1965.
When a criminal starts misusing me, I am going to use whatever is necessary to get that criminal off my back.
Did you discover any parallels in his writings and his speeches to life as a black man in 1992?
You look at the way the film opens, you know, here we have this footage of Rodney King being beaten and the words of Malcolm X from 30 years ago, and you know, it's nothing's changed. You know, absolutely nothing's changed, you know.
Denzel Washington is among a handful of artists who are redefining the way African Americans are portrayed on film. He says movies like Malcolm X and Glory tell important and often forgotten lessons about history.
I'm proud of the fact that I've been able to share history with people. You know, I mean, people, I did not know that 180,000 black people fought in the Civil War. Most people probably didn't know that, so I'm proud to be a part of a film.
Your mouth would be forced to
That's not the only reason I do movies, but I'm finding it increasingly difficult to just do any kind of movie. You know, I think there's just too much work to be done. You know, and I like to maybe do mindless romps or whatever. You know, and you need that too. People go to the movies to enjoy themselves, but these are the kinds of films that excite me, like Glory or like Malcolm X.
Washington won an Oscar for his role in Glory. The Oscar may have made him well known, but it hasn't opened every door.
Oh, thank God I get to use this.
I still couldn't get a cab in New York. Still can't. Maybe I should carry the Oscar around. Hey, whoa! Hey, it's me! Still can't get a cab in New York. I sat out there last week and I just wanted to see. It took 28 minutes. 13 cabs passed me by. So, no, to answer your question, it hasn't opened up the world.
Denzel Washington told me he hopes the movie will serve as a source of healing for everybody. And tomorrow, the man who made Malcolm X, Spike Lee, and be in our next hour when Gene Siskel gives you his review of Malcolm X. 5 before the hour, we'll be back. It's going to be just beautiful. That's the national forecast this morning. Harry?
Thanks, Mark. It is billed as a million-man march, a huge demonstration in Washington, D.C., organized by Louis Farrakhan of the Nation of Islam. But while it's being called a rally for black unity, blacks are far from united about the march and its message. Abdul Allah Muhammad is a top assistant to Farrakhan. He is in Washington this morning. And in Hartford, Connecticut, Congressman Gary Franks. Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning.
Mr. Muhammad, let me repeat to you a quote from Harold Ickes, who's the deputy White House chief of staff. He called statements made by Minister Farrakhan bigoted, hateful, anti-Semitic, and sexist. You think those words describe Minister Farrakhan?
Not in the least. There are a lot of words that have been used. None of them describe Minister Farrakhan. If Minister Farrakhan were all the things that he has just been described as, you wouldn't see this throng that's out here today.
Mr. Muhammad, is this a black litmus test? If I'm really black, will I be at the million-man march?
No, it's not a litmus test. There are a lot of black people who are not at the Million Man March. There are far more than a million black men in America. We did not expect them to all be here, but those who are not can participate in the ways that Minister Farrakhan has outlined. They can stay at home, they can pray, and they can begin to reflect on the things that they need to atone for personally.
Congressman Franks, let me ask you the same question. A lot of people see this as a kind of a litmus test, as that Mr. Farrakhan has thrown down a gauntlet, so to speak, and said, if you're really black, you'll be here today.
Well, most African-Americans...
Let me ask this question. This is for Congressman Franks.
Most African-Americans would not agree with the message of Minister Farrakhan. The black Muslims have been around for a number of years, for three or four decades. And over the years, African Americans have said no to the separatist ways of the Nation of Islam. African Americans have said no to hating whites, hating Jews, and hating Catholics. The similarity between the Nation of Islam and the Ku Klux Klan would be identical on those points. And they both believe in having a separate type of America.
So you liken, you liken the Nation of Islam to the Klan?
Well, when you talk about hating whites, Jews and Catholics versus hating blacks, Jews and Catholics, and they both believe in having all white people in one place, and the Nation of Islam would believe that they should have their own little state or country.
So what does that make the people...
Very similar. They're very similar. I'm not saying that the Nation of Islam would believe in killing people or would lynch people. No, I'm not saying that. But when you're talking about hatred, when you're talking about race baiting, there's no question that the Nation of Islam, Mr. Farrakhan, plus he's a sexist. I mean, all women are supposed to stay home today.
Congressman, let me ask you this then. If you follow Minister Farrakhan to Washington, D.C., what does that make you?
Well, I think that a number of people who went to Washington, D.C. went there not thinking truly that this was going to turn out to be a glorification of Louis Farrakhan, which it has. It is a march being led by the Nation of Islam. We will see that all day. And that, as has been stated, people who are attending under the guise of Mr. Muhammad are attending because of Louis Farrakhan. I know a number of people from Hartford, Connecticut are not down there because they believe in the separatist views of Louis Farrakhan.
Let me ask you one question, Mr. Muhammad, very quickly. Can you separate this march from the man, Minister Farrakhan?
No God, but Allah.
You don't. You don't. Minister Farrakhan is the one who had the vision given to him by God to have this march. And the proof that God is the one that put it in his heart is that God put it into the heart of all of these black men that you see out here. And Mr. Franks' statement that we ask all the women to stay home, we ask the women who would to do specific things at home.
Right.
Now, since all our children are grown, my wife is right over here with me.
Okay, we've got to go. For now, Mr. Muhammad, Congressman Franks, thank you very much. Paul?
Thanks, Harry. Right now we want to talk...
More harsh words today from Louis Farrakhan as the Million Man March on Washington draws near. And a massacre in Bosnia despite the ceasefire. This is the CBS Evening News. And this is Bob Schieffer reporting. Good evening. Well, there's more controversy today over remarks by Louis Farrakhan, the Nation of Islam leader who is organizing the March of Black Men on Washington Monday. Farrakhan tried to tone down his latest remarks about Jews being what he called bloodsuckers by saying he was also referring to people of other races who had taken from the black community and given nothing in return. But he had harsh words for black men who are not attending the march, calling them today self-righteous fools. Cheryl Atkison is covering the story, and we start with her report.
This country, why are you here? You are here to join the army. An army that's going somewhere.
A prayer breakfast that lasted well past lunch kicked off the Million Man March weekend. Organizers said a government run by white men could no longer ignore the needs of black men.
We are not going to wait for them to open the door. As a matter of fact, we're going to open the door or break it down.
After an upbeat rally in Chicago, Louis Farrakhan, the controversial organizer of the march, dismissed new charges that he's espousing racist hate.
This march is about us coming together, looking at the problems of our community, and resolving to do our best to solve the critical problems that we face.
But for Jewish Americans, Farrakhan's history of making remarks seen as anti-Semitic cannot be separated from the message of Monday's march.
The tragedy is, the irony is, that this Day of Atonement and Reconciliation is being flawed because the man who's organizing it, the Pied Piper, is a Pied Piper of hate.
The Million Man March has sparked dissent among many blacks as well. The NAACP is one of several civil rights organizations refusing to support it. Ousted executive director Benjamin Chavis says the NAACP leadership does not speak for all members.
Will all the members of the NAACP please raise their hands? Will all the members of the NAACP who are going to support the Million Man March please raise your hands?
It's everybody.
With the march only 2 days away, workers in Washington are still in the early stages of preparations. The rain didn't help. Although in St. Louis, several buses bound for the march were found vandalized, there was mostly elation among participants boarding buses for the nation's capital. And Atlanta had a march of its own today. Hundreds braved a drenching downpour to deliver a different message. Men of all races were invited to join in and celebrate love, peace, and harmony. But Farrakhan lashed out at black men who chose not to be part of the Washington march because they think they're decent men.
That's your problem. You're a self-righteous fool.
There's no way to tell whether a million black men will come to Washington Monday. Park police say they're expecting 2,000 buses and nowhere near a million people. But organizers insist more than 11,000 buses are headed this way. For the march to meet its million-man goal, 1 in 10 adult black males will have to show up. Cheryl Atkison, CBS News, Washington.
Good evening from Capitol Hill. Whatever the true numbers finally turn out to be, and the Park Service estimates them at 400,000, this event, billed as a million-man march in Washington, did draw a tremendous crowd. At one time, it was a sea of people from one end of this mall to another and beyond to make history, to witness history, to change history. Among the stated goals today, highlighting obstacles facing the nation's African-American men and rededication to overcoming them. This march has also drawn tremendous controversy and criticism over the message and goals of the man who led the march, Nation of Islam leader Louis Farrakhan, and whether his goals today can be separated from past messages widely seen as racist and anti-Semitic. Our coverage begins with Russ Mitchell. In Texas today, President Clinton sought to promote racial unity among Americans in a speech that supported many of the stated goals of today's Million Man March here. But as White House correspondent Rita Braver reports, the president also distances himself in miles and mindset from many of the stated views of Louis Farrakhan.
President Clinton's speech today before a mostly white University of Texas audience half a continent away from Washington directly confronted the national racial anguish the Million Man March has highlighted. Mr. Clinton said it is a rift that is tearing at the heart of America.
Both sides seem to fear deep down inside that they'll never quite be able to see each other as more than enemy faces, all of whom carry at least a sliver of bigotry in their hearts.
The president tried to strike a balance, condemning vile behavior by both sides. He praised the goals of the march, but was careful, without mentioning his name, to distance himself from Louis Farrakhan.
1 million men do not make right one man's message of malice and division.
And likewise, without mentioning Mark Furman's name, Mr. Clinton urged whites to denounce racist comments by the notorious white Los Angeles police officer who investigated the Simpson case.
The taped voice of one policeman should fill you with outrage. So I say we must clean the house of white America of racism.
The president urged whites to recognize the roots of black pain and blacks to acknowledge the roots of white fear. Above all, he appealed for racial unity.
We dare not tolerate the existence of two Americas.
But late today, Farrakhan took the president on for painting him as a purveyor of hatred.
I'm not filled with malice. But I must tell you that I come in the tradition of the doctor who has to point out with truth what's wrong. And the pain is that power has made America arrogant.
A senior White House aide responded that the comment shows why Americans should repudiate Farrakhan while still honoring the good intentions of the marchers. Rita Braver, CBS News, Dallas.
Tonight on the CBS Evening News, we're pleased to welcome back to our broadcast veteran correspondent colleague and friend Bernard Goldberg for his new reporting assignment, which is sharing his unique perspectives on events of the day. To start off, he brings us, and you, his journalistic insight and analysis of today's Million Man March here in Washington. To begin, what we call Bernard Goldberg's America.
White supremacy has to die in order for humanity to live.
Besides all the stated goals of this rally, Louis Farrakhan has a goal of his own, to be, as Martin Luther King was, the most respected, admired, and followed black man of his time. And if white America doesn't like it, that's white America's problem.
White people have to come out of that idea which has poisoned them into a false attitude of superiority based on the color of their skin.
What other black leader could draw so many people to one place at one time? The last one was a minister, too, who spoke with a different kind of moral authority.
The Negro still is not free.
In 1963, Martin Luther King marched on Washington demanding justice, too. But back then, blacks and whites marched together. And maybe it was too optimistic, but the dream was about a new day in America when color would not be nearly as important as character.
Little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today.
Louis Farrakhan has a dream too, besides that of black self-reliance and self-help. It's a dream of separation, a dream of two Americas, one black, the other white. Race relations haven't been this bad in a long time, is what you hear, mostly from white Americans. Why were those blacks cheering when O.J. was found not guilty?
Oh, my word.
A lot of people think blacks were sending white America a message.
Black unity ended in confrontation today. Tensions had been building for weeks as organizers fought with city officials over plans for the so-called Million Youth March. Randall Pinkston tells us what happened when tempers boiled over.
At the beginning, the atmosphere for the Million Youth March, which actually attracted fewer than 30,000, was almost festive.
It's time for us to rise.
The audience hoping for a positive event.
It's about the youth and the kids. It's about unity amongst black men and women.
But city officials who lost a court battle to block the rally prepared for the worst. A small army of police saturated the rally site, closing off blocks, angering local residents.
We have been put in our place.
We're in a lockdown.
The chief organizer of the march, Khalid Muhammad, the former disciple of Nation of Islam leader Louis Farrakhan. Muhammad has been sharply criticized for his inflammatory rhetoric about Jews, Catholics, and gays. Today, Muhammad showered his audience with a short but incendiary speech aimed at New York City officials and police.
We want you to be steadfast. Look these bastards in the eyes. And if anyone attacks you, already decide who will be the one to disconnect the railing where you are and beat the hell out of them with the railing where you are.
According to the court order and city officials, the rally was supposed to end at 4 p.m. At 5 minutes to 4, Khalid Muhammad had only begun to speak, and police began to move in.
At 2 minutes after 4, as Muhammad moved away from the microphone, police in riot gear moved towards the rear of the stage. As the fiery speaker made a hasty exit, chairs, barricades, and garbage were thrown at the officers. City officials said police moved in quickly because the rally had exceeded its time limit. Lost in the melee, the youth in whose name this march was called. Randall Pinkston, CBS News, New York.
A boy who was first charged...